budget. This is a requirement of state law, so it happens every year. The school committee invites the public. Is that better? Is it on? Is that better? Yes, got it. So I just opened the public hearing for the school budget. As I was saying, this is a requirement of Massachusetts state law. Every year, the school committee holds a public hearing where members of the public can come and speak and share their thoughts, their opinions, their ideas, and ask questions about the proposed budget. Beginning next week, the school committee will deliberate and discuss and work towards coming to a vote on the budget. A couple of ground rules. There is a sign-in sheet right there. So if you would like to participate in public comment, by all means, sign in on that sheet. We're going to go in the order that people signed in. When you speak, you are going to, there's a microphone right there. We'll ask you to approach the microphone. I'll ask you to identify yourself by your name and your kind of connection to the Reading schools. Are you a Reading resident or a parent or whatnot? So share your name and your connection and then and participate by giving public comment. We will mostly be listening because it's a hearing. We're here to hear the points of view of the public, so we will be listening. If people have specific questions that are very quick and very factual, I will allow Dr. Doherty or Ms. Dowd to answer them. If people have larger, more complex questions, here's the process we're going to follow, and it's the process the school committee follows. Ms. Dowd, our Director of Finance, and Dr. Doherty will be writing down all questions that are asked. And on Monday evening at our next meeting, they will be publishing responses to those questions. We do that for a couple of reasons. One is to give them time to adequately research and give a proper answer. The other is so that these questions can be included in our budget book, which ultimately goes to our town's finance committee and then to town meeting, which is the approving authority of our budget. We want everyone in the public to have the opportunity to hear the questions asked tonight and hear the answers. So with that, I'm actually going to kick off the public hearing tonight. I received one email this afternoon from parents here in Reading, and I verified that they did want me to read it into the record. So I will read this. It is from Jennifer and Scott Harden. Dear school committee members, we are writing regarding the superintendent's 2017-2018 proposed budget. We are not able to make the public hearing this evening, but wanted to present our comments to you. We are the parents of three boys, one having graduated from RMHS in 2013, one currently in sixth grade and another in fifth grade. While we acknowledge that we are unfamiliar with the complexities and inner workings of a complicated school budget, at first glance, there are a few things that don't make sense to us regarding the drastic middle school teacher and language cuts. The elimination of something as important as language while salary increases are occurring elsewhere is simply absurd. While we understand that all positions are beneficial, if not necessary, given the lack of funds, we believe that the prioritization of cuts is flawed. There are several other positions that, in our opinion, would have less of a negative impact were they to be cut instead. It seems to us that positions like extra school psychologists, extra speech and language teachers, school adjustment counselors, and perhaps even the extra assistant principal at the high school would impact students less. Do we need more than one of these positions at each school? Also, while professional development is important, might this money be better spent on language by decreasing our numbers of professional development? They go on to propose some positions to eliminate, which I just articulated. We understand that there may be factors here that we are not aware of, but we wanted to voice our concern and hopefully help to come to a better solution than the one proposed, which results in our kids being even more underserved by the public school system than they already are. Our youngest two were not taught cursive handwriting or spelling after the second grade, two subjects which are very important to a child's education. We're asking you please not to cut language from the seventh grade. Thank you for your time and consideration. Dr. Doherty.
So our first, we have two speakers that are going to speak together, Jennifer Gray and Leah Christie.
We will, but after.
Good evening, Dr. Doherty, school committee members, and the Reading community. I am Leah Christie, and this is Jennifer Gray. We are both seventh grade foreign language teachers at Parker Middle School. We speak tonight on behalf of the Foreign Language Department. It is imperative that our collective voices are included as part of this conversation. As individuals who have chosen to devote ourselves first to many years of studying foreign languages And then, facilitating the passage of this knowledge to our youth, we would be amiss not to be heard on a matter we care so deeply about. Tonight, we are not here to plead for our jobs, but for a program that we believe in so strongly, and for what we feel the students of Reading so greatly deserve. First and foremost, as Dr. Doherty did bring up during the initial FY18 budget meeting, offering foreign language to eighth graders only as an elective is a major step backwards for our district. To regress to a model that was used almost 30 years ago seems unimaginable. Foreign languages bridge gaps and connect people. In this time of divisiveness, it is paramount that we use education to cultivate empathy and tolerance. Today, when multiculturalism is of utmost importance, why would we delay our students' opportunity to begin learning in this area when many other districts are pushing to start it even earlier in their elementary schools? Most comparable towns have foreign language in seventh and eighth grade at the very least, if not beginning in sixth grade or earlier. How disappointing that while Reading is facing the possible dissolution of foreign language at the middle school level as we know it, neighboring Wakefield is considering adding a position to bring foreign language to the kindergarten through fourth grade classrooms. We have not taken for granted the caliber of education Reading offers, and we were proud to be part of this high-achieving program. The seniors that are graduating from this program, they go to college and they are very proficient. Today, in the very essence of what makes Reading an outstanding district seems to be in jeopardy. Reading students will be at a major disadvantage compared to their counterparts in other districts. Dr. Doherty also warned that he used the term recommended budget lightly, indicating that by no means does he feel these options are what's best for students. Research supports that regarding the implementation of language instruction, the younger, the better. If children cannot start around the same time they are acquiring their native language, it is acceptable developmentally to start at the onset of adolescence, though far from ideal. Therefore, starting it in ninth grade is simply too late.
Seventh grade or earlier is the prime time to capture students' enthusiasm for a new subject area and take advantage of their curiosity, willingness to take risks, and authentic enjoyment of languages and culture. We foreign language teachers know that removing foreign language from seventh grade would not just rob them of the curriculum, but also the experience. Beginning language learners, learning younger lends itself to effective methods like singing, chanting, acting out skits, games and movement, and cultural exchanges. These students may miss out on traveling and visits from exchange students. When else will your children have such rich opportunities? Let us not forget that foreign language supports the general curriculum as well. Foreign language strengthens students' knowledge and awareness in English classes. They will recognize roots of words and be able to speak more accurately about parts of speech and rules of grammar. At times, foreign language instruction parallels social studies, building upon geography and cultural aspects of countries studied. Foreign language complements mindfulness of learning styles and helps develop study skills that can be used across the board. The foreign language classroom promotes a sense of community where everyone is starting on an equal playing field and they root for each other and help each other succeed. If this recommended budget moves forward, students will not be able to access the significant curriculum, as the number of classes offered will be cut in half for eighth graders, and there will be no foreign language for seventh graders. The job of seven teachers will filter down to just two of us, combining 2 years of instruction into one. Consequently, there will be a need for more Spanish and French 1 courses at the high school, and because a significant portion of students are starting late, some students will not reach AP levels, weakening what was once an admirable program. True fluency will be just out of reach. We could see students leaving the district to seek entrance to private schools, schools that meet more their academic aspirations. If Reading is truly committed to offering a rigorous curriculum and preparing students for a global world, this decision truly contradicts those goals. Thank you for allowing us to add our insight and for the support you've afforded us during this trying time of uncertainty for our district. Please continue to fight for what's best for the students of Reading, more foreign language, not less. Thank you.
Was very clear when he presented this budget. This was not his recommendation or what he thinks is best. It's living within a very difficult fiscal circumstance. I'm guessing everyone in this room is aware that our committee will be charged with cutting $1.4 million from a level service budget this year. So thank you for acknowledging that point, and thank you for your comments, which were very articulate and very compelling. Thank you.
Julie Merrill and Andrew Spinelli, when I'll talk.
Good evening. My name is Julie Merrill. I am a sixth grade English language arts teacher at Parker Middle School. I'm also a lifelong Reading resident, graduate of the Reading Public Schools, and my mother was also a lifelong Reading resident, graduate of the Reading Schools, and taught in the Reading Public Schools for many years.
I'm Andrew Spinelli. I've been a seventh grade English teacher at Parker Middle School for 7 years. We wanted to just take an opportunity to talk a little bit about some of the maybe public misconceptions about what might happen as a result of the cuts to the sixth grade English department. Basically, the suggested or proposed budget would reduce ELA in sixth grade from a 2 block a day to a 1 block a day. And while many people might believe, well, at least they're still getting English, we have significant concerns of the impact that will have on the quality of education, not just in sixth grade, but the effect that it will have in the seventh, eighth grade, and high school curriculums moving forward.
Okay. The adjustment to middle school is a challenging one for many of our students. With the double English block, we have been able to make this adjustment more manageable through focus on organizational skills, time management, and studying strategies. A reduction in English language arts periods will mean less time to devote to the development of these critical skills, which aid students in accessing the curriculum and meeting the expectations of middle school. Additionally, this results in the elimination of 4 full-time teaching positions, which means that the remaining sixth grade ELA teachers will be responsible for twice as many students throughout the school day. Such a drastic increase will not only negatively impact our ability to identify specific students' reading needs, but it may also alter the rate at which we are able to identify the social and emotional well-being of our student population. Often, ELA teachers are able to bring issues to the team concerning individual students based on our additional time with these students and smaller student population. The loss of the double block would mean issues that previously had been identified earlier in the year might not be addressed as quickly, and interventions may take longer to develop. Currently, due to the 2 class periods in sixth grade ELA, teachers are able to also alter the pacing of their curriculum, revisiting concepts that might pose difficulty for students, and providing a specific period each day in which the focus can be on both reading and writing. The loss of this time means an acceleration of the curriculum and less time to build upon or emphasize concepts in greater detail. The reduction of instructional time in English language arts and subsequently changes in the schedule across all grades may also have a negative impact on the students in the Bridge program at Parker, which was formerly referred to as the LLD program. Currently, students are able to receive special education services specifically in reading and writing during the 2nd block of ELA. This allows enough time and flexibility to create a balance of targeted interventions, small group instruction, and inclusion activities within the ELA curriculum. Although Bridge students will still receive services decided upon by respective teams, regardless of the schedule changes, it may create less flexibility in their schedules, resulting in fewer opportunities to participate in specials, preferred activities with peers, and less opportunity to integrate in integrate with the general ELA classroom.
Much of the current sixth grade ELA curriculum deals with the direct teaching of such skills as inferencing, identifying main idea, theme, and the components of plot and the elements of fiction. Students entering sixth grade are often not yet proficient in these areas and require great amounts of explicit instruction. They are still building many foundational reading skills. The focus on the direct teaching of these skills at a sixth grade level means that by seventh and eighth grade, students are better able to focus on the analysis of literature and higher critical thinking skills. The loss of direct teaching time for these concepts would mean more basic skills need to be taught in the upper grades, which would result in slowing down the present seventh and eighth grade curriculum. Moreover, the elimination of the double block will leave less time for sixth grade English teachers to address reading strategies specific to the content areas. The consequences of this will be felt by students as they progress through middle school and content area reading requirements become even more involved. And just to kind of build off of that idea, rigor has become a calling card of our curriculum in the middle school English department, and we are very proud of that as a department. Our number one concern is for our students, that they will not be given access to the kind of curriculum, mainly because they're not coming into seventh or eighth grade with the same foundation. I had the opportunity to have a junior from Endicott College come and observe my classroom today while she was working on part of her thesis, and she was really blown away by the level of thought and sophistication of the kids as they were working. And I can't take all credit for that, nor would I. It has to do with the amazing work that's happening from the elementary level on, that these kids are coming into seventh grade with the foundation of reading, with the foundation of writing that we are lucky enough to get to build upon. Without that double block, it's not feasible to think that we could continue our curriculum at that pace, and that scares me for my students. As teachers of children first before content, we are fearful of the results of cutting current ELA time in half in sixth grade and losing four individual teachers who are dedicated to students at such a pivotal transition. We strongly encourage both the school committee and the entire Reading community to support an April override that will help us preserve the high expectations and the quality of education that we currently have for our students. As teachers, it's what we expect of ourselves, and we know it's what our kids deserve. Thank you.
Thank you.
Eric Goldstein and Dr. Jeffrey Ryan.
Good evening. Members of the school committee, my name is Eric Goldstein, and I'm the president of the Reading Teachers Association. I'm joined here this evening with Dr. Jeff Ryan, another member of my executive board who serves here at the high school. We're here tonight on behalf of all the members of our association to request that you call a vote and to ask, this vote would ask the Board of Selectmen to put forth to the voters a Proposition 2.5 override ballot question in April. And we're asking you to support a limited tax increase to offset the school department's projected deficit in the fiscal year 2018. Passing an override is needed to stop the budget cuts that will have a long-term negative impact on our students, our schools, and our community if nothing is done. Now, we accept that the results of the October special election weren't good, and the Reading voters rejected a more ambitious $7.5 million override. However, we believe that many voters were rejecting the size of that increase, not taking a categorical position against increase whatsoever. The override we are suggesting is about a quarter of the size of the October proposal. We are optimistic that voters in town would consider such a plan to protect our public schools, which are among the best in the state and are the heart and soul of our town.
Again, I'm Jeffrey Ryan. I'm a history teacher here at the high school. I've been here for 20 years. And I've seen nothing but improvement and flourishing and great things happening. And it seems like what we're about to see is the beginning of a slow and tragic death. We here represent teachers, parents, and elected members of this school committee, and we have a responsibility to do absolutely everything possible to prevent the impending budget crisis and cuts from harming our schools and, more importantly, the children that we love. Passage of this override would save 21 positions that are currently slated for elimination. Important benefits, if we do this, and I hope we do, include maintaining a foreign language program for the 7th and 8th graders at the middle school. In our globalized economy, learning a second language is not a luxury. The earlier you start, the better. Preventing an increase in class size in grades 3 through 5 at the elementary school. Teachers and parents know what research has proven. Students who are educated in small class sizes typically learn more than those in larger classes. Retaining 3.3 kindergarten paraeducators, teaching assistants who help provide our youngest students with the individual attention they desperately need. Retaining a math instructional coach, an important role as education in the STEM subjects, science, technology, engineering, and math become ever more important. And finally, preventing the elimination of college prep level classes at the high school, as well as the reduction of offerings in art, business, and physical education. The necessary corresponding suspension of graduation requirements in order to make this budget work is a clear step backwards for all of our students and our community.
These cuts also come with more hidden costs, which are still important, so I want to mention them. For example, without an override, the district plans to eliminate professional development in special education and greatly reduce professional development funding in general education. Any business that wants its employees to learn and grow and keep up with the evolving strategies and technology needs to provide their employees with professional development, and so should our public schools. Families are also directly affected by these cuts, since the district intends to increase fees charged for athletics, full-day kindergarten, and extracurricular activities, services that we believe should be available to all students regardless of their ability to pay. We urge you to take our request for a vote under serious consideration. No one in Reading is in a better position to make the case for our students than you as members of the school committee, who were elected to protect, support, and improve the public schools in our town. Thank you for your time.
I just want to make one more comment, please. I know I have a reputation for being a bit verbose. I'll try to be quick. I have been corresponding in person and by letter and online with dozens, if not hundreds, of current students and alumni and faculty from this district. And I must report to all of you, I sense nothing but a looming sense of dread and doom, and that the Reading School District is about to commit institutional suicide. I know that may sound as a rhetorical overreach, but I don't really think so. If we destroy foreign language, if we destroy reading, we really are falling on our own sword. The entire community is facing a destruction, the deterioration of what makes this, I think, the greatest town in Massachusetts, a place where I could have retired from teaching several years ago, and I want to stay here because I love it. I love the students, I love the faculty, I love the people. I want it to be as great as it's always been. And if you folks cannot support this override, we're doomed. Thank you.
At this time,
that's correct.
In your budget, there are proposed fee increases for RISE preschool and athletics. Just a point of clarification. Thank you both for speaking.
Andy Friedman.
I think this is Andy. Hi, my name is Andy Friedman. I'm a budget parent for the high school, and I'm also the proud parent of two Reading High School graduates and a junior who would deny me if she was here. First, I want to thank you for all the work that you do on such low salaries and the effort that you've put into this budget. That said, and you know, I don't think we can necessarily count on an override at this point in time. I would please ask you to do all in your power to consider cuts that would not affect the faculty, which are really the heart and soul of our school system, and which I think the impacts of which have been already expressed by some of the teachers here. You know, of course, not all the teachers in the school system are perfect. My kids have had a lot, and they run a spectrum. But by and large, they're all very caring, giving individuals who have done a great job educating my children. And I would hate for that not to happen for future generations. So please, I urge you to look at the budget, take another look at it, and see what you can do to prevent cuts to things like foreign language, which not only is good for, you know, the new world economy, but it also makes people, it makes kids smarter. I mean, not knowledge-based smarter, but brain plasticity increases and stuff like that. And the last thing I'd like to say is that I was disappointed that the budget was developed without discussions with the teachers, who really, they're the people in the trenches, if you will. And contrary to what some people may think, they don't just have their own special interests at heart. They really care about, a lot of them care about, all education from K through 12. And I don't think you would get totally biased input from them. I think you could probably, we would all gain a lot of benefit from listening to what the teachers have to say about how to balance and how to handle the budget cuts. So thank you very much for listening.
Jessica Kaufman.
Hello, my name is Jessica Kaufman. I'm a parent at Killam, to a first grader and a fourth grader. And I have a question about our priorities in this budget. I wanted to see if it would be possible to reduce the number of teachers cut if it stays at the same 1.4 million from a level service budget by eliminating or cutting significantly the building-based budget funds. So this is from the January 9th regular day center budget presentation. It's page 24 in the PDF version of the slides. The building-based budget funds are around $160 per pupil. They vary slightly from school to school, but they total $682,000, and that would go a long way towards changing the number of teachers who are cut. The personnel reductions for teachers add up to $846,000, and I think that is something that is undoable in a way that teacher cuts are not. If we cut the building-based funds, parents have to buy paper towels. If we cut teachers, we can't undo it the next year if an override passes. Thank you.
Nathan Giacalone. I hope I said it the right way.
Hello. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Nathan Giacalone. I was a graduate of RMHS here in 2015, and currently I am a student at UMass Amherst. And what I can say is that growing up, I was always told how Reading Public Schools were some of the best, not only in the area, but Eastern Massachusetts, possibly the entire state as well. And I've always seen great programs, great teachers, and I was very fortunate to have gone through a school system such as this. And so a couple weeks ago, when I was first told of how the foreign language program was looking in these severe budget cuts, I was very taken aback by it. And then when I went to the meeting on this last week, I learned how there was a lot more to the story than at first I thought. It was a lot more complex than originally I saw. And going through that budget meeting, looking through the program, I feel that most of the cuts seem to be focusing more on the educators and the direct student areas than other administrative areas in the town or in the school system. And as a student currently navigating the college life, I can say that of all the areas in the high school time, that foreign language is possibly one of the most important. Currently, I'm trying to look for internships, and I found one particular one it's a business internship, and within 5 minutes, looking into this, I saw this particular company talks about how it is a global network-based systems. And as we prepare to move into more graduating classes, more students moving into the professional world, it's a much more global system than we faced in years past, and so that's why it's ever important to focus on the foreign language areas. And I feel like that's being disproportionately affected in these budgets, and I'm not sure if this question necessarily falls outside the scope of this committee, but I wasn't sure if there were more cuts being focused on not just school administration, but town administration as well. I'm not fully versed in the complexities of that area, but after reviewing the budget thing from the last meeting, I would have to say that that was one of the things that surprised me, that there were comparatively few administrative aspects, mostly it was affecting the students. And going off what one of the committee members said last meeting, it's an ebb and flow, that there are hard times, which currently we're in right now, and eventually, sooner or later, we're going to get out of it. And I feel as if that the important thing is to try and look at what areas we need to cut, what areas we need to keep strong. And clearly, we're not in perfect circumstances, and I feel like we're not addressing the right areas that need to be cut. And I feel as if that since eventually, sooner or later, we're not going to be in this tough situation. And so in order to have our students best prepared for when we finally get into a point where our town is not in such dire need or dire straits in this financial budget setting, that we need to do everything we can to protect the core academic subjects, with foreign language being one of the most important, that several people here have touched upon how it not only makes students smarter, but it prepares them better for a global setting. And as a student currently enrolled in university setting, I can fully say how those who do have a foreign language background are much better prepared than the ones who don't have it. And so I simply ask that we reassess the areas where we're making these cuts and maybe try to find ones that are more feasible and hopefully find something, a budget that the most people can agree on is the best way to get us through these difficult financial times. Thank you.
Julie Wall.
Hello everyone, I'm Julie Wall and I'm a Reading resident and parent. Thank you for the opportunity for me to speak this evening. I've lived in Reading for 6 years. I have 2 children, aged 5 and 2. My husband and I both grew up in a neighboring town, and upon being blessed with the news that we were to be parents, we searched and ultimately were so fortunate to find a home in one mutually desired community, Reading. desired for many reasons, and most important, Reading's long-established reputation for its excellent public schools, whose community all the while maintains a down-to-earth, small-town feel. 2.5 years ago, when my daughter began preschool at Reading Integrated School Experience, or RISE, I experienced the privilege of becoming part of a most supportive community of families, educators, and administrators, one that has continued to expand now that she is in kindergarten. Every day, I marvel at what my daughter and her classmates are learning and at the efforts of their teachers and other school staff to advocate for their students so they may grow academically, socially, and emotionally. I chose to speak tonight not only as a parent, but as a former 7th and 8th grade Spanish teacher in the towns of Tewksbury and Topsfield. I can tell you from personal experience that teaching a new language to middle school students is rewarding and purposeful. The enthusiasm with which 12, 13, and 14-year-olds embrace and absorb a new language is magnetic. Over the first few days of school, I always shared with my students and their families that I also began learning and loving the Spanish language as a 7th grader. In fact, I enjoyed it so much that I chose to make a college major and career out of it. The potential reductions to any school program or educator's position, including those of the world language departments at Parker and Coolidge, truly disheartened me, as I sympathize not only with the teachers whose livelihoods are in jeopardy, but with the current and future 12, 13, and 14-year-old boys and girls whose potential joy for learning a new language may be compromised as a result of our making reductions to the current curriculum. As our town endures these financial hardships, I have no doubt that our community will band together to ensure that our children will continue to benefit professionally and personally from a well-rounded experience in the Reading Public School system. I am so encouraged by the community turnout this evening. We, residents, families, town employees, and town volunteers are all here because we love Reading and are invested in its future. I respectfully ask that our community examine and exhaust all financial possibilities before deciding to eliminate any portion of a program or educator's position, not only with respect to middle school world languages and the kindergarten paras whose jobs so greatly and directly benefit my own daughter, but within any one of our town's 8 schools. Thank you all so much for your time.
Alicia Williams.
Hi, my name's Alicia Williams. I'm the mom of 3 kids, a 7-year-old at Birch Meadow and 2 other smaller children, ages 4 and 2. If I have any food on me, that's why. I watch how hard these teachers work, and I love our teachers. I know how much they love their jobs and how thankful I am that we have teachers that work so hard for our kids. I'm heartbroken to hear of the loss of language knowing what other districts offer. We're starting down a slippery slope. Where does it end? We need to find money in the budget cut. We have to go to bare bones, not cut teachers. When I looked at the budget, the professional development line item of $1.3 million kept sticking out. As I sit and listen to the potential cuts to language, this line item seems excessive. Compared to other districts, we spend $315 per pupil on professional development versus the state average of $197. When you say $1.3 million, it's a hard number to swallow when we need a $1.4 million to level the budget. Please don't think that I believe that professional development has no value. Do we have ways to offer less expensive professional development? Has this been explored? Maybe do professional development at night. I understand how much professional development can help the staff grow and learn new skills. As I read and reread the budget, I wonder if anyone tracks in Reading the teachers' professional development. Have we surveyed the teachers? Do we collect our own data on whether they like it? Do they want more? Has anyone ever asked the teachers, do they find it helpful? Do they want less? For 185 days, we spend $378 per teacher on professional development. And quickly doing the math, it comes out to $119,000 a day for the district. We can break this down by the cost of subs across the district. In the end, I feel we can squeeze more money from the budget. I asked the school committee before you cut the teachers, you look into the professional development line item and help save our schools. We're running out of things to cut. Thank you.
Kelly Ward.
Hello, my name's Kelly Ward and I'm a sophomore here at RMHS. Thank you for the opportunity to speak here tonight. I'm here even through midterms. to voice the opinion of many students regarding the new budget. I know that this budget was difficult to create, and in every new budget presented, there are difficult decisions, but I would like to present student input on the issue. Even though the money in this budget comes from the taxpayers, which we're clearly not, we are students who are impacted by these decisions. The main decision that we would like to address tonight is the changing of the foreign language curriculum. As students, we are most concerned about the changes of the foreign language curriculum. I, along with many other students, have benefited from the foreign language program. We have learned not just a language to help us better communicate, but have also been exposed to different cultures. The teachers in the foreign language program department are fantastic. For example, my middle school teacher, Senora Barbera, has helped a group of us before midterms and finals for the past 2 years of Honor Spanish, and now Honor Spanish 3. She goes above and beyond what is expected of her, and we can't thank her enough for all that she's done for us. Besides cutting the teachers, this will have an impact on the students of Reading. We are concerned that the changes to the foreign language program could negatively impact the school's profile in the eyes of colleges, especially the more selective colleges. The students who are younger than me will not even have the opportunity to participate in the language program to the extent that I did. Taking foreign language was almost a rite of passage in middle school. It was a huge deal when you were picked from a lottery to select your language. It was awesome. Now students will miss out on this middle school learning experience. More importantly, many may not even have a solid enough grasp on Spanish 1 from the proposed elective schedule. Spanish 1 met every day for 2 years. By cramming it into an every other day schedule, I don't see how it's possible to build a solid foundation in any language in that amount of time. If there is no possible way to change this decision, would it be possible to supplement with a summer foreign language course similar to the summer geometry course offered? Or would it be possible to restructure some of the courses that are valuable but are not mandatory for getting into college, such as some of the arts or the gym requirement? While many of us have been enriched from these programs, including myself, I've participated in Arts Fest for many years and participated in many years of band and then guitar. When it comes to making the difficult decisions, we must make the decisions that will best help us to reach our long-term educational goal of getting into a good college.
Hi, my name is Catherine Growney. I'm in eighth grade at Coolidge Middle School. I would like to also add to the point of the usefulness of Spanish. For example, my mother uses Spanish every single day at her work in the hospital, and sometimes it helps her to save a person's life. If she had not taken Spanish in middle and high school, this may not have been possible. The main point that students, myself included, would like to stress is that we thoroughly enjoyed this program, and not only did we enjoy it, we need it. We need the language program to keep us competitive as we prepare to apply to college. I would like to respectfully present the following petitions as signed by students of the Reading Public School System. One is from the high school in Parker, and another I am passing along from the Coolidge students. In total, 521 students have signed these petitions, and there are more circulating around the high school.
Thank you for your time tonight, and I hope that the student input will be taken into consideration. Thank you. Now I have to go cram for my Spanish midterm.
Miriam Downing.
Thank you. My name's Miriam Downing. I'm the parent of a fourth grader and a sixth grader at Parker who will be directly affected by the loss of language. And I just wanted to point out something that I haven't heard, which is right now there are seventh graders taking language that may not make it in the lottery next year, and I don't know how that affects somebody's learning when, you know, if only half the kids get it, you've started a language, then you've stopped, and then you have to restart it in ninth grade, and maybe it just doesn't make sense. Even if you're going to somehow, these cuts have to remain, at least grandfather the kids in the seventh grade. But that's not really why I'm here to speak. I was trying to think of what can we do to save positions and what can we do in the budget. And a few things were jumping out at me as I looked at the budget, the munis budget, and peer districts. And one initial thing I noticed is there's a fair number of non-collective bargaining positions in this budget that are getting raises well above 3%. I see, I'm not to disparage these positions, but an occupational therapist getting 7.73% raises, secretaries 12% raises, school psychologists and school adjustment counselors 6.5% raises. And you can probably add all those up and save a position. And I really think someone ought to look at that and draw a 2.5% line or some line matching the town cost of living increase or whatever we set and say why there may be reasons why these people are getting bigger raises. Maybe they're taking on more responsibilities. I'm not privy to that. I just went through munis and some things didn't make sense that there were such large raises. So that's one place to look for money. Another place, building a bit on what Alicia Williams mentioned, was professional development. I think the professional development is important to our teachers, but like when we choose a new curriculum and when we look at other things, what is the data evidence showing benefit to student outcomes of a given professional development? Is it possible to, I would like to see a list of what we've done and what is the data supporting improvement in student outcomes, because I feel like looking at the DESC, our spending has been going up, and I don't know what we're spending it on, but I know at least at Joshua Eaton, there has not been an improvement in student outcomes in some grades. I think Mr. Sprung is taking a different direction this year. Going to North Reading to observe teachers in ELA, that sounds like free professional development to me, other than the cost of a sub. So I support it, but if there's a way to determine what's effective and not just, oh yeah, the teachers think it's great, but no, we did this and student reading levels went up by the end of the year in this school versus another because we had PD. That I believe in. So I think taking a more selective look, it may look like, only $50,000, $60,000, that's a teaching job or an early on teaching job. And my last point, and this is something I'm not sure if the teachers will like, but I'm just going to throw it out there. So I was looking at the length of days in the teacher contract, which is 185 days. And I found all the peer districts in the budget and a bunch of other districts. I looked at 24 districts. We have the most number of teacher days, like the extra days in service, 185 days of everybody. One district has 186, but their kids go more to 182, so the average of the 24 districts I looked at was 183.4 days. And we also start school earlier. If I'm correct, we make our teachers come in 2 days in advance, but most districts do 1 day in advance. There were three other districts, Tewksbury, Woburn, and Hingham, who do 2 days, but the average is 1.16 days. And I wonder, I know we can't talk to the contract, but if those things were put on the table, like Alicia was saying, every day that all the teachers have to be here, collectively it's like 119,000. An average teacher salary is 70,000, that's 378 a day. So yes, an average teacher cutting 2 days pay is about $800, but collectively they can save a few jobs. So I just want that to be under consideration. And I, like Mr. Goldstein said, I support a smaller override if it were possible. I think we have to look at the mood of the town and find out. It can't just be about the schools. There's people that are going to say we need police officers. But I'd like the school committee to try to look at these kinds of things and be creative. And maybe the teachers can think, do we really need 5 extra in-service days? Would we be like all the other districts, would 3 be okay in saving peer jobs? So that's just all I have. Thanks.
Can I just give a point of clarification on the beginning comment that Mrs. Downing made, because I just want to make sure people understand. Occupational therapists, secretaries, school psychologists are all in collective bargaining units. Yes, they are not non-union employees. Rebecca Lieberman?
Hi, thank you for the opportunity to speak. I'm Rebecca Lieberman. I'm a parent of two high school students and an RMHS graduate who came through with a fantastic education. I'm here to plead for teachers and for the college prep track to remain. I feel that there are areas in the budget that would have much less impact, and to echo what others are saying, there have to be additional areas we can cut. I refuse to believe that we have to sacrifice our foreign language program, ELA, which is such an important subject, and it is so important for sixth graders to get that level of writing instruction. I also have a question related to the collapsing of the CP track and SCP tracks of the high school. For those who aren't aware, this is we currently have in 9th through 12th grades, we have a college prep track, strong college prep, and then honors. And then in upper grades, we have AP as well. And to combine the CP and SCP tracks, not only would it harm many students, because the former CP track students might be struggling to keep up in the more rigorous course, but it might actually wind up costing the district additional funds, because if the former CP students need additional supports in order to keep up. I really feel like that should be, that curriculum change, because it has such a huge impact, should be taken maybe outside of the budget discussion to have a separate discussion on whether that's a good thing. Apparently, this has already been happening in ninth grade history, and I would like to see some data on whether this is shown to be effective. How do teachers feel about the collapsed tracks, where they now have a greater diversity of students in their courses? How do students feel about it? Are the CP students able to keep up? We need some information before we go and roll it out, as is the plan apparently for the 9th through 12th grades, which apparently is coming, and in more courses. In addition to history, the plan is to also collapse the CP and SCP tracks for science, which is a very different subject, and for English. Again, a very different subject. If someone struggles with writing, then being in a more rigorous English class could be devastating. I have pleaded with you many times for a middle track pathway to calculus, because I've told you about my son's struggle to keep up with kids who get the material more quickly than he does. And I worry that you are dooming a whole bunch of additional students in many subject areas to the same sort of struggle. And I just refuse to believe that there's nothing else we can cut. I have some specific suggestions, as others have. I was taking a look at professional development and whether there could be some cuts there. It's also very difficult to read the budget in its current format. Like, it's hard to determine what the total cost of administration is across all the areas, including special education, central office, and regular education. And if we could get a collapsed number with a percentage of with a proportion of the budget that is administration, and how that compares to past years, just to see. And also, I hope that we would consider raising fees. I'm as a swim parent, which is one of the more expensive sports because there's pool fees. I would be very open, and I know other swim and hockey parents, I'm sure, would as well, to some kind of surcharge for the more expensive sports to save teacher positions. If there was a way to remove some of the athletic spending from the regular school budget, And for some of the, even though it's smaller amounts, why don't we look at the PTO funding graduation, things for graduation, awards coming from band parent organization or the swim parents, just being creative, raising fees, having a parking fee, although I understand that the town owns the high school parking lot, it still seems a shame that, I mean, if the town gets more money, then they can provide the school with more money, because I don't think we can count on an override. There are also some other expenses that have gone up a lot. Professional salaries, under there are other salaries under athletics, it's up $39,000. I don't know, page 45, I don't know what that is. Professional extracurricular salaries up $12,000. Again, I don't know what that is. And so I believe that there is more that we can cut before teachers, which should be the absolute last resort. Thank you for your time.
Nancy Doctor.
Nancy Doctor. I actually want to remind everybody, the school committee particularly, the advice that John Arena, and John, please tell me if I'm misquoting you, gave every department last year. He said that instead of taking a budget and making cuts, you need to start with a blank piece of paper and put your most essential personnel and essential services on it and build. I can't think of anything more essential to a school department than the teachers, followed by the curriculum. So I would hope that you would take his recommendation and look at what is the most important thing in the school department. And I say this with the utmost respect, that you would be willing to justify to me and to the community the laying off of any teacher or cut of anything in the curriculum over paper or furniture or athletics or administration or academic coaches or even beloved services like full day kindergarten. Thank you.
Later who'd like to participate in the public hearing. Yes, thank you.
Hello, my name is Mary Richards, and I'm an educator and a parent. My older daughter could be here making a passionate plea for foreign languages and French, but she's studying for her midterm. She has the benefit of being in AP French, thanks to starting in seventh grade at Parker. Her little sister has been deciding what instrument she wants to play and what language she wants to take for a long time and changing her mind a lot. She's in sixth grade. She's benefiting greatly from the double ELA. She's very bright and is getting a lot of extra help from her teacher, Miss Merrill. There's extra help on across the spectrum with that double block. I am concerned that we are retreating from our mission as a school district. We're walking away from acknowledging that we are preparing our students for a global society. I feel very, very fortunate to be talking to you right now. I appreciate your hard work, and I value the role of individual voices in democracy. I worry about if there's no foreign language in seventh grade, what are these kids doing during that period? Maybe that was discussed at a prior meeting, I'm not aware. And similarly, if a student is not able to get into eighth grade foreign language, what are they doing during that time? What is the educational opportunity open to them instead? And lastly, I see a hope that we could pull back a little bit in a lot of places and not a lot in a few places. And I am in favor of raising fees on optional activities, sports, arts, although I have a lot of friends on the swim team and in the band, I think those are not what should be going ahead of some of our core academic subjects. Thank you.
Good evening. I'm Joanne Alvarez, and I'm the head of the Foreign Language Department here at Reading Memorial High School. And I am so grateful to everyone that's come out here to support whatever programs, especially for foreign language, but all of the programs. We don't want to have to cut anything, and I know that the school committee and Dr. Daugherty and everyone, they've tried very hard. But I have to tell you, I just think it's a very sad day for Reading if they can no longer support the foreign language program as they've always done in the past. While other schools around us are adding and maintaining elementary programs, we're cutting. It's just so disheartening to see Reading selling its kids short. Please understand that I'm not criticizing our hardworking school committee or administrators who are trying to do their best in a difficult situation. They have always been friends of foreign language, as most people are in this town. They would like their children to have the opportunities that the others have had, whether it's to continue language study through junior and senior year, or to participate in one of the trips or exchanges that we run. So I'm appealing to all of you people of Reading to think it through and see if you can come up with more ideas to help us out. Now, I'm foreign language department head at the high school. I don't supervise or evaluate or even observe or interview teachers at the middle schools, but we do meet. We have our district PLC meetings. And they're a wonderful group. At the high school, we have 12 people teaching Spanish, French, or Latin, including three part-timers. I teach three sections of Spanish included in there. We're the smallest of the five core subject departments. The middle schools have seven teachers of French or Spanish. Now, I understand the limitations. We all know why, you know, Reading doesn't have the tax base that a town such as Burlington might have, and that some towns can spend more than others on a per pupil per year than Reading can. But in looking at Dr. Daugherty's figures, I was bowled over to see, you know, Burlington spending 19,000 something per pupil per year and Reading at 12. I know we don't have malls, but there are other towns too that don't have malls. I look at North Reading and see they've just built a beautiful high school, middle school, and they seem to be maintaining their programs. So it's very upsetting to me that things are going this way in Reading. I have loved teaching here every year, and I would continue to do so. The other day, I spoke to one of my seniors. She said that she and her family had moved to this town for the schools, and they're very happy here, but now she's seeing her former town doing better at education than Reading is, and this is so sad. I really hope that something can be found to fix it, because I don't want to see people start moving out of this town to look for better schools. Now, I know before the override, people were told what was going to have to happen. It was not hidden. I don't know. Did they not believe that it would come to this? I don't know. But I can tell you, the day after that override didn't pass, we were just coming to school that day. I can't tell you what the feeling was like. It was very different. And I know how much support There was among parents, especially of the school children of Reading. Reading parents have always been supportive, but still, it was a really sad day for teachers here at school. In a few weeks, though, I'll be leaving with a trip. We're going to Spain with the student group, as we do on our exchange, and our students will stay with their friends that they hosted in the fall. It's a great opportunity for the kids to use their language skills in the real world, but it's not easy for our kids to do it because their kids from Madrid start learning English when they're five. And our kids always feel a little bit, you know, oh, but they're fine. They do very well. I'm just hoping that, you know, in the future, we can have our kids start learning languages even younger. After we get over the situation we're in now, I would love to see our programs go down as other towns are doing, and I have a wealth of information and data and statistics that I could show you, but I'm not. I just want to tell you stories tonight, because every year that I've gone on this exchange in Spain, I'm running into our kids. The very first time after, you know, the second exchange, we ran into a student, and he came to visit us at our farewell party. He was there to say to me, Mrs. Alvarez, thank you so much. I am doing an internship here in Madrid. It is so much fun. The last time we went, ran into a student who was studying at the University of Granada, and she is now on a teaching career. Next time we go, in a few weeks, I hope to meet up with yet another student who is studying in Spain. So not only are they learning the language, they're happy, they're going to the culture, they're learning about the world. They're just amazing. So a shout out to all of you, Beckwiths and Tormans and Emmons families and everybody. It's been a great, great experience. But again, in our country, only fewer than 1 in 10 people really speak a foreign language. And in the rest of the world, half of the people, as a matter of course, just regularly every day, speak at least 2 languages. So we're behind. And I know you want to support the foreign language thing. So let's look at our dilemma right now. I don't understand how on earth 2 middle school teachers are going to be still standing after the cuts, either rehired or hired or whoever they are. How are they possibly going to be able to take a job that has twice the expectations? They're going to be visiting 2 schools every day. And you know, teaching middle school is hard enough. Our current middle school teachers are great, as you heard. They're great with the kids, they work so hard. But imagine if you had to do your job twice as much, twice as fast, every single day. Could you do that as well as you're doing your job now? Something would have to give. And what's going to have to give is our program, as you heard from Leah and Jen and everybody. Right now at the high school, we currently offer 30 sections of Spanish, Spanish 1 through AP. We have 7 Spanish teachers, not all full-time. 12 of those sections are, no, I'm sorry, 18 of those sections are upper-level courses of French or Spanish 4, 5, or AP. 18, and we have 30 Spanish, 12 French. In Latin, we have 1 section of advanced Latin. So there are a lot of opportunities for seniors and juniors, and they're taking advantage of those opportunities in great numbers. We have a really wonderful relationship with these kids that want to continue. Many of our classes are not small. Oh, one note. Someone mentioned to me that on a recent document sent out by Dr. Daugherty about the numbers of classes and things, that it may have indicated somewhere that Latin ended at sophomore year. That's not the case, so I'll look into that. Anyway, of the 50 sections that we teach, these kids that continue on, we only require for graduation from high school 2 years of a foreign language. Many of our kids continue on to junior and senior year, and we're so proud of them. But with the cuts, those of us at the high school may also end up having to be more teachers of beginners. as we take up the slack, since not even all the eighth graders are going to have the opportunity to take a foreign language. Also, the longer they wait, the more difficult it may be for them to get started. Also, think about the transition now, because they're going to be going from four core subjects in the middle school, most of them, whoever doesn't get into the eighth grade program, to five core subjects at the high school. That might be difficult as well, and have a wider gap. Even when they get to the second year of language at the high school, it might be a gap for the teachers here. Looking at the kids that took the Spanish one at the high school or took it at the middle school. So there's that little segue in there too. We don't know how that's going to work. I believe the transition will also cost us money, because the Spanish one books and French one books that we use at the high school are not the same as the ones they use that are geared for the middle school. So somebody's going to have to buy new books. More thoughts. Language is cumulative. It takes time to absorb it. And the more you're exposed to the language, the more you learn. You can't just listen to more hours of language lessons and be expected to absorb them faster than is humanly possible. Otherwise, we could all listen to the radio and speak instantly. A sponge can only absorb water so fast. Sometimes we might be in a hurry and squeeze the sponge to try to pick up some more water more quickly. I don't want that to happen to the kids. Eighth graders shouldn't be expected to squeeze 2 years into one, and neither should their teachers. Language learning just doesn't work that way, and it's certainly nowhere near best practice, and we know this. Language study develops the brain. How many of you guys actually know half of the numbers stored on your cell phones? Aren't you embarrassed when you don't even know your friends' numbers anymore? Even if you don't care about that, if you think of what's happening to your brain, there are many scientific studies that show the brain benefits of language study from the cradle to the grave. Studies of babies show that they retain more than we think they do. Bilinguals even more so. Students who study languages do better on tests and all kinds of other subjects, since their brains are making more connections. And the elderly who have studied languages retain more memory skills as they age for the same reason. Language study develops the brain the way exercise benefits the body. No matter what you call it, by cutting seventh grade out, we're reducing kids' exposure to language learning to a maximum of five, not 6 years anymore. And I believe that the five will only be for those few who are invited to do so or win the lottery, however it is, and choose to study a foreign language over the other wonderful electives, which is also said. It's going to be a tough choice and not a fair one. Our world needs all kinds of people, and in Reading, we have to give kids the opportunity to be who they want to be or who they should be. I'm not sure about the selection process. As fair as it may be, it's still going to enable a select few to rise above the rest sooner, which may create more elitism within school. In Boston, Marty Walsh just announced something about full-day kindergarten for everyone, because we, especially in public schools, should be providing equal opportunities for our students. This is not an equal opportunity. Foreign languages should really start in kindergarten or before. Imagine starting math, science, history, and English in the ninth grade. How much could you do with that? And what will the criteria be for the selection? How can we predict a student's performance in a subject he has never even seen before? Many of our stellar seniors in AP Honors or SCP courses have come a long way since freshman year. They learn, they grow, they branch out in different directions. As it stands, we'll be cutting out roots and eventually chopping off the top of the tree as well. As our graduates said at the January 9th meeting, they noticed a big difference in student ability in foreign language when they met kids who didn't begin, at least in middle school. An academic subject should not be placed opposite electives. The Massachusetts Foreign Language Frameworks, which have been around for 18 years, defined languages as one of the five core subjects. How will it look for our district when accreditation times comes up if we're reducing our core student time? Also, foreign language teachers teach a lot more than people think. This isn't your grandma's foreign language class anymore. We begin with vocabulary and reading and writing and listening and speaking. But our classes also teach our students to be confident global citizens and encourage their development as human beings who can interact and converse with one another face to face, as well as using technology. We also touch on so many subjects by the later years: history, literature, art, economics, philosophy, and the many, many facets of world cultures, to name a few. Language is the most essential skill that defines us as human beings. The opportunity to actually speak to another face-to-face is going out the window in many situations, so we want to encourage that in our students. No matter what we do, the world continues to turn around us, and we can either choose to learn about it or not, but we ignore it at our peril. The more our students learn about how to interact with others who may be different from them, speak other languages, and observe different customs, the better for their future and our world. In conclusion, I would like to thank my students who inspire me and teach me things every day. I feel so lucky to be here and to know them because they are amazing people and will do great things. And also because they make me laugh and feel very proud at all they do. Especially when they do things like last night, they were sending me pictures of themselves studying for my exam at 10:30 at night. They were showing me their 25 pages of study notes that unbeknownst to me, they had made as their for their study groups. They're amazing, and they deserve better. I would like to thank you. Thank all the people that have participated in speaking up at these meetings. I encourage you to tell your stories as well. The petitions and the support, they're wonderful to see. And whether or not anything can come of this right now, our kids are still learning about the process of standing up for what they believe in. And I hope that this town can come through for them. Thank you.
Hi, my name's Emily Soria.
And I'm Lucy Whitelum.
And we're here, we're seventh grade students at Parker Middle School, and we're here representing all of the middle schoolers that signed that petition and others that weren't able to. But we are, we're just so thankful for the opportunity that we were given this year to take a language. I know that when I was in sixth grade, I looked forward so much to taking French. And it has, so far this year, it has been so much fun and so educational, and I'm so grateful for that opportunity. And I have two younger brothers, and they're both in elementary school, and they're already talking about what language they want to take. And it just, it makes me so happy to see that they want to learn that much, and that right now we have that opportunity, but it's going to get taken away for them in seventh grade, and it saddens me a lot. And I think that taking a language in middle school is really important because it broadens your knowledge of the world, and it helps you become more confident because you're trying something new and these weird words that you've never heard before. And I just think that it's really, really important for us to do as much as we can to keep the foreign language in seventh grade, and thank you.
Adding on to what Emily said, I feel like foreign language is more than just another subject that you study in school. It helps expand your knowledge of culture and other people's point of view. And all I could think about at the end of sixth grade is, what will it be like to learn about all the people in France or Spain or whatever language you take? And I've learned so much from this, and I've had a great time doing it. And so many people that I've talked to from dance or from school or anyone that I've talked to, they're all looking forward to taking the language, and it's a shame that they might not have that opportunity, because everyone looks forward to it, and it makes a big impact on their life, and it helps them be open to new ideas, and helps them with more than just that subject. It helps them with reading and writing and just all other things. So thank you for this opportunity to speak.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Arison Engel. I'm a parent of a kindergartner and a 3-year-old. I'm also a teacher for the public schools in Chelsea. I'm also a Connect the Tots board member here in Reading. And I've been living here for about 4.5 years, as I've met so many families through Connect the Tots who have also been here for about 3 years, 4 years. They just moved here, very similar ages. And everyone says, yeah, the school systems are great and the community is so wonderful. And then, so this happens and this is happening. And I'm gonna keep this short, I'm super nervous, I'm sorry. So we came for the schools and we love the community, but then we see and hear on the Board of Selectmen's meeting just the other night, I'm sorry, I can't take any of this out of context, the police report of what's going on, and crime is up and drug overdoses are up, and we're talking about cutting school positions, and there's no health department in the middle school, I mean, health program in the middle school. And I can't take any of that as separate. And it just, it leaves me wondering, this is all I'm really gonna say, is what are we left with? You know, if we're cutting back on school and crime is up and drugs are up, what are we left with? And my sort of lasting statement is the prioritization of the school will be, and that's a fact, it will be what keeps the town afloat while we're trying to figure out what to do about the other stuff. And that just has to be the facts. So that's all.
My name is Joellen McGinnity. I've been a Reading Public School teacher for 21 years. I teach fifth grade at the Killam Elementary School. I wasn't planning on speaking, but I was moved to do so by listening to the students and the parents and my beloved colleagues, my union president, everybody who turned out and have been standing here for a long time tonight. Our superintendent has been completely transparent with us. He's had office hours. He's heard our concerns. This is a community that cares about each other. You might remember that I came before you last spring because I felt very passionately about the adoption of the No Adams science curriculum at the elementary level. We decided to adopt that program for grades 3, 4, and 5. I spoke to you from my heart about how important I believed moving into the 21st century with skills such as reading and writing in the content area and an integration of science, technology, engineering, and math was. I'm not going to be able to teach that curriculum in the same passionate way that I know it needs to be taught if I have 27 children in my class. 27 children in one science class, and in the second science class, and in the third science class. 27 children that I have to teach guided reading and language arts to, who will then go to my colleagues who are sixth grade ELA teachers down to one block, and they will be even less prepared with what they need to know about main idea in detail and how to infer. And students who will have less opportunity for me to be aware of their needs in a trauma-sensitive environment that we're trying to provide for our children. And it's not just me, and it's not just science. It's my colleagues at kindergarten who rely and desperately need the support of paraeducators to meet the social and emotional needs of five-year-olds that are being asked to do more than five-year-olds used to be asked to do. Kindergarten used to be about play. Now it's about reading and writing and math facts and exposing them to things that will get them ready for the next grade. So anywhere across the line, this is a pebble in a pond, and we really have to look at if the community would be willing to consider an override. I have to say that in the fall, I was very concerned because the language was confusing. It was yes for Reading and no on two. And there were many people who had a difficult time discerning the difference. Was it no for Reading and yes on two? I had plenty of conversations with people and had to try and clarify that point. So I think we do need to take the pulse of the community, and we do need to explain what we need. I'm very proud to be a Reading Public School teacher. I tell everybody what I do. And for the first time, I just don't feel hopeful about what it's going to be like going forward. And that's a terrible way to feel when you leave a career that you love. Thank you.
My name is Anson Hong. I'm a high school senior here at RMHS. I'm here tonight instead of studying for my AP French midterm, which is a certain level of irony in my life. But as a student, I can assure you that I am privy to a level of high school gossip and talk that I would rather not hear. But nothing has been as pervasive and as universally talked about as this budget cut, and in particular, the foreign language program. And its challenges and the challenges that it's facing right now. So if you want to know what the student body thinks, they want foreign language. And on the chance that after everything we've heard tonight that you can't save foreign language, I wanted to make a couple of contingency pleas. Number one, if you have to keep eighth grade as an elective, please do not limit it to a lottery. I can't fathom the idea that we would be denying, even in part, the education of an eighth grader who wanted to learn something new. And if we can't save the foreign language, I would like to push for a more rigorous classes in the following years to make up for that missing year or so. Because as an AP French student right now, what I see in the level of work that I'm doing and the work that my classmates are putting in, if I was missing a year or two of language, I would not be ready for this course. I could not do this. And after a year or two, I would see that the AP foreign language program would disappear. There would not be enough students ready. French changed my life. That's a bit of a strong wording, but it did. Because French and English are such similar languages, my knowledge of English and what I learn in English class feeds into French class, and what I learn in French class feeds into English. So it's like a positive feedback loop in how I perceive the world around me through language. I want to end on a note of hope. For as a brother, my sister took 4 years of Spanish and 2 years of Latin as an RMHS graduate. And after her second year of college, she's taken 2 years of Korean now, and she has declared her major in linguistics. So, language is important. Thank you.
Hello, my name's Susan Gelotti. I'm the mother of a sixth grader at Coolidge. And I really can't say enough about the teachers there. And on both the English, the two-period English, and the language is what I would like to speak about. My daughter came into sixth grade with some difficulty with the English, and she has just blossomed with the two periods. I've seen such progression with her, and it's gone from being kind of on the bottom to one of her favorite classes. It's helped her in her social studies, her science, and her math. I am not a good public speaker, and this is really hard, and I do appreciate all that you guys are doing to work on a budget. I know it's a difficult position to be in, but I come from a family of, my mom was German. She learned languages as a young kid, and when she came to the United States, she spoke three languages. And it was just the importance of languages. My daughter has looked forward to this for the past 2 years. I work as a social worker with different communities, And I can't tell you what a benefit it would be for Reading kids to have a second language, especially as we become more diverse. And I do realize this is really difficult, but I would like you to consider, you know, looking at other options and not take away that foreign language option in the seventh and eighth grade. And I echo the selection, offering it as an elective and having a lottery, I think is just really sad. And I think it would cause problems with other students if someone gets selected and someone doesn't. So thank you.
Was there? Yeah, okay.
Good evening. My name is Brian Gilberti. I have two daughters that are currently going to the Killam, and we are blessed with the fact that their excellence is matched only by their compassion. The teachers there are excellent. And I would like to commend the school committee. You have been put into a difficult position, and it is not easy to try to make a balanced budget. However, when it comes to numbers and when it comes to the complexity of something like a budget for an entire school system, I think there's one thing that sometimes escapes us, and it's the fact that teachers are the beating heart of the building. They are the school. Everything that we see around us, this library, that laptop, this microphone, all of this stuff is nothing without the teachers. So as you go through the budget, line by line, at every single line item, please ask yourself, is that more important than a teacher? Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Jill Damari, and I have had four kids go through the Reading Public School System. Two are in college now. I have one at the high school, here at the high school, and one at Parker Middle School. And I am a current full-day kindergarten paraeducator at Barrows Elementary, a class of 18 students projected to be 22 to 23 next year. I think it's wonderful that some high school students have come to tell you their concerns, and the foreign language issue is also very important. But I'm here to represent the students who cannot be here at this late night meeting, the kindergarten kiddos, who often rely on the other teacher in the classroom to have their needs met, to fix their boo-boos, tie their shoes, dry their tears, hold their hand down a steep stairway, or provide a hug when they're having a particularly rough day. I don't think we can underestimate the importance of having another full-time adult in the kindergarten classroom for safety issues, emotional concerns, and most importantly, academic issues. Kindergarten used to focus mainly on social issues, how to play fairly, how to be a good friend. But now, kindergarten is more like first grade. We're expecting so much from these 5 and 6 year old kiddos, and they need the support of a full-time paraeducator in the classroom to support their teacher. Thank you.
Is there anyone else who wanted to speak during the public hearing? Oh, we got, yes, go ahead.
Hi, I know we've all had been spending a lot of time here tonight. My name is Kate Boyd. I'm a parent of a student who will be going into kindergarten next year. I also work in Wakefield Public Schools at the Galvin Middle School. Anyways, a lot of what I've been listening to, I kind of just think of, it's so compelling, it's so moving. But it's like, what can we do with that? What, we're kind of stuck in this situation, so how do we move forward? The most compelling, I think, just like the logistical thought, how to save money, for me anyways, was with the PD piece. I'm thinking to myself, just working in schools, and public speaking is not my forte, I'm sorry if I'm nervous. But who are we developing professionally when I think of just the sustainability, the morale, the support, like how these teachers must feel and what they will feel dealing with the cards that they've been dealt and completely out of their control. What's the retention going to look like for Reading moving forward? Are we professionally developing people for 1 year so then they can move on to different districts that are more competitive with their pay rate, with more manageable caseloads? It doesn't make any sense to me. I think just listening to those numbers of what we're spending per staff person on professional development, when we have so much to learn from one another as professionals, as veterans, people who just, again, working in public schools, we learn so much from one another. And if we lose that, if we lose each other, it just makes me so sad and so, so scared for the future foundation of this district, and for the little innocent faces that I kiss every night goodnight, and what they'll have the opportunity to be a part of in this community. So thank you so much for your time. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Hi, good evening. I wasn't prepared to speak, but my name is Brynn Burkhart. I am the mom of a kindergartner at Killam and a third grader at Killam, and I want to thank all these great Killam teachers for being here tonight. We have such an amazing school. My son is in kindergarten. He's in a kindergarten class of 22 people. I can't imagine not having a para in class next year. The social and emotional growth of our students is going to be stunted from kindergarten, and it's only going to get worse. My third grader had a class of 17, which was amazing, until this year when it went up to 24. He's got a wonderful teacher, thank you, Mrs. E, this year, who does the best that she can with 17 boys in a class, especially mine. But, you know, the class sizes of 27 to 29, as Mrs. McGinnity said, is just appalling. And it's just doesn't, I'm saying what everybody else has already said, but it breaks my heart to think that my child is going to be in a class of 27 to 29 for the next 2 years, and I won't even touch the foreign language piece. One of the things I wanted to ask is, I was watching the school committee meeting last week on RCTV, and I know, Dr. Doherty, you said that when you considered all the different options for the budget, you had chosen the least, or the best of the worst, I think. The least bad of the bad, right? And I know at that time someone had asked, you know, what was the next least of the bad option? And at that time you declined to say that, just citing kind of morale and not wanting to, you know, lower morale of any of the staff. While I understand that, I think morale is already a little shaky. And I want to just ask, If there was some more transparency, or at least if the school committee was able to avail themselves of all the other options that you considered, and maybe they are, so I guess I'm asking a question, because I assume you went through different iterations before you came to this budget. But if you weren't able to share it with the public, was the school committee able to see the different options that you considered before you got to this current budget, so that they can make an informed decision?
Thank you. And I'm going to allow it because it's a pretty straightforward question, but we're not going to get too far into answering questions. I'll include it next week.
Okay.
We need to be very careful because other reductions that we discuss involve people. Everything that we're talking about primarily involves other people. So when we start putting other positions out there, and people start hearing it for the first time publicly, you create a bigger issue. Bigger than what it is now. Yeah. So I will tell you that we started working on this budget on October 19th, the day after the override. And the administrators and I spent a lot of time talking about what were the reductions, and we pretty much knew $1.4 million was the number. And we went through 10 different iterations of the budget before we were able to present it publicly. We did have some conversations with school committee when we met with them individually, of some of the other things that we looked at.
Okay.
I can't get into
that. That's fine. I respect the process. And if there were other people that were affected, and it was going to be more people, and 21 is the best of that, then that's unfortunate. But thank you. Thank you for your time. And thank you for your work.
Hi, my name is Sophie Jalot, and I have three girls who are all going to public school in Reading. And being from France originally, I am very upset about the fact that the town will be cutting languages, foreign languages. I think this is critical. My kids are bilingual, French and English. My seventh grader is learning Spanish, and it's very easy now for her to learn another language because she already knows how to speak French. I think in today's world, it's very the global economy, it's very, very important to be able to speak another language. I've learned English, Spanish, and German when I was actually living in France. It's very common to learn more than one language when you're in Europe. So I think having even just an extra language other than English, it's critical. Kids today need to have another language just to be able to understand first other culture, have to get another opinion of how people think. If we take this away, it's really going to hurt them into their long-term career. When I used to work before having my kids, I traveled all over the world, and this really helped me, having all the languages, to be very sensitive to other cultures. And I think we really need to look at the budget and see if we can maybe cut other things. I know it's not the best solution, but maybe, you know, music, art, everything. There are so many organizations in Reading, such as Creative Art or Alpha Omega, who can provide all these services. If you want to have if you want to learn another language, you would have to go through a tutor, which is about $50 an hour. And I'm tutoring French, so I know what I'm talking about. I also teach French to younger kids in after-school program, and I know how fast they can learn when they're younger. Once you hit ninth grade, 10th grade, everything becomes much more difficult. So I think you really, really need to start early. Eighth grade as an elective, it's even already too late. Sixth grade would be perfect. Seven is kind of almost, the limit. But I think if we take away foreign languages, it's really going to impact kids into their future, into their career. And I think if we could try maybe to cut other activities, maybe music and art, I know it's not the best solution. It's very hard, and it's, I love these other activities. My children play the music. They love art. But if you had to choose the less worse, I think keeping foreign languages is extremely, extremely critical, because we are now living into a world where we actually need these languages. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Lena Williams, and I am a parent here in town of a kindergartner as well as a second grader. Not only am I a parent here, but I am also the director of guidance here at the high school. And I came here tonight not expecting to speak. I was just going to sit in the back and just be the person who's listening to all the recommendations and the thoughts of the parents and just sit there quietly. And I got a little bit of peer pressure from a friend of mine to speak up because of conversations we've had together. One of the things that I have said to many of the people who are on the board of the school committee, as well as the administration, and sometimes I feel like a broken record, but I just want to remind not only the committee and administration, but all the parents here, that when we have such drastic cuts like this, especially at the elementary and middle school, it has a negative effect on the high school and then students moving forward. So as the director of guidance, I sit here every day and I work with students with some serious social emotional issues. It's devastating to work with these kids who are struggling every day. I'm sitting here looking at my son's kindergarten teacher, and he gave her a run for her money. but without her hard work in the lower class sizes, which personally I think today are too big, but to have the thought that they could even get bigger, by the possibility of dismantling the middle school model, it will have a negative effect on the social-emotional well-being of our students. We have a high number of students who are hospitalized at the high school level. We have a high number of students who need therapeutic programs. We have a high number of students who are experimenting risky behaviors, and they need our support. My worry is that we have those issues now. If we don't take care of our kids at a young age, it's just going to get worse. And we're looking at budget cuts now, but we're going to need more money years down the road. When these kids are in large class sizes now, they're going to have the negative effect when they come into high school. So my recommendation is for the school committee to go and recommend another override. For the parents in this town, if you can speak up to the Board of Selectmen and encourage another override. It's easy for us to sit here and look at and nitpick all the different things that Dr. Doherty has kind of recommended. He's not in favor of any of these things. He has a really hard job, but it's really hard to say we need one thing over another. So I'm just recommending the parents in this town, as well as the school committee, if we can consider another override. Thank you.
Mr. Quorum.
I'm Jeffrey Quorum. I'm a budget parent for the high school in Coolidge. I've been a PTO treasurer for a number of years. I'm also a strong supporter of foreign languages. I took AP German and had a Fulbright in Germany for a year. But, you know, I think, as Dr. Doherty said, this is the least bad of the bad. And that really, in some sense, we're kind of preaching to the choir. I think everyone in this room supports foreign languages, supports art, doesn't want to see that cut. And I think it's really important that the people here who are passionate about these things go to next week's financial forum and ask the town, look, can we fix this? And maybe not with RTA representative talked about a very small override that might get us, I don't know what the numbers would be, but I'd hate to see a small override only take us 1 year and us to be back here again next year cutting the exact same positions with less support from the community that said, hey, we just did an override. What do you mean that didn't solve the problem long term? And really, the people who are here who are saying, you know, what benefits the foreign languages have or the extra English, you need to go talk to your neighbors. You need to talk up with them, the people who don't have kids in the school yet, don't have kids in the school anymore, or never had kids in the school, and say, look, you know, this is really critical for your home values, for the kids in the community. And I was a little disappointed, too, in the newspaper headline that came out last week that said that the superintendent recommended a 1-point-something-rather-percent increased budget. I think anyone who was in the room and paying attention to what was being said, he said clearly he was not recommending this by any stretch of the imagination, and it did a disservice to the town to say he was recommending that on the headline.
Is on Wednesday, January 25th at 7 p.m. So 7:30 p.m. at the library, the public library, not this library, the public library. Thank you, Mr. Quorum. Is there anybody else who'd like to speak during? Why do I not? Oh, did you want to speak, Ms. Vandenacker?
Yeah.
Okay, sorry.
Hi, I'm Sherry Vandenacker. I just wanted to emphasize something that Mr. Quorum said, that this is the fourth year of budget cuts, and what will we cut next year if we have another $1.4 million deficit? As painful as this is, it could only be the beginning if we don't address the problem.
Anybody else this evening? I'm not seeing anybody, so if I'm about to wrap up the public hearing, so if I'm missing you, please jump up and down and wave your arms, because I don't want to deny anyone the right to address the committee. Absolutely not. I want to thank everyone for coming out tonight. This is a very challenging time for the community, very challenging time for the schools. The input you've given is very helpful. and your engagement is very important, so please continue to be engaged. I will try. Is that better? I'm very grateful. I know the committee is very grateful for all the engagement and all the input this evening, and I'm going to ask you to continue to be engaged, continue to attend meetings, continue talking to your neighbors. It's a very hard time. But thank you for being here tonight. I will now close the public hearing. I am going to take a 5-minute break to clear the room for anyone who'd like to. President. I'd like to call the January 19th, 2017 School Committee back to order. Our agenda indicates that we are doing a consent agenda, a consent agenda this evening, but a component of it was not included in the packet, so we're just going to put off the entire consent agenda until our next meeting, so we will not be doing that. I am going to call for public comment, which after 2 hours of a public hearing seems kind of funny, but we always begin our meetings with public comment. So if there's anybody who's here tonight not to discuss the FY18 budget, which we just had a hearing on, and not to discuss the school's facilities budget in general, but for some other reason, if you could let me know that you'd like to speak. Seeing no public comment. We do have reports listed. Do you have any from the administrative side? We don't have student representatives today. Does anyone on the committee have a report that is very critical and can't wait till Monday? Yes, financial forum, I said it earlier, I'll say it again, Wednesday night, 7:30 at the Reading Public Library, not the school library, the public library. There'll be a financial forum, a joint meeting of the Board of Selectmen, the Finance Committee, the School Committee, to look at the FY18 budget and some of the impacts that we're looking at. So I encourage anyone in the community who's been following this process to please attend that meeting. Any other reports? Okay. Yes, of course.
People that we do have a CPAC meeting this Saturday at 9 o'clock downstairs.
Thank you. Saturday morning.
Saturday morning, 9 o'clock.
Bring your own coffee.
Bring your own coffee.
Got it. Okay. And Mr. Huggins, thank you for being here this evening. I understand you're going to take us through the core budget.
All right. Thank you for having me, everybody. Well, we did this last year. This is a slide everybody probably saw last year. We're going to start off with our mission statement, department overview, organizational chart, some technology that we use, some new technology that we use to manage the facilities department, our key functions, building information, some 2017 capital projects that have been completed as well as remaining projects to be completed under this year's capital, and some special projects that were completed within the last 12 months, and we're going to bore you with some statistical information on what we do, and then also just give you a quick department budget summary. So that's our mission statement. We never had a mission statement before, but we felt it was necessary to do when we formed the core facilities department. So the facilities department is responsible for the repair and maintenance and capital of the 8 school buildings and 9 municipal buildings totaling just over 1.1 million square feet of space. We manage a staff of tradesmen made up of an electrician, plumber, and a carpenter. And it's important to note that those three gentlemen are traveling within the 1.1 million square feet of space doing the repair work. The remaining work is outsourced with HVAC controls, elevator repair, and a lot of the larger state-mandated inspection work that we do. But a lot of the day-to-day stuff is getting done with those three gentlemen. Cleaning of the buildings, the school facilities, is accomplished with a staff of 23 full-time custodians. Contract cleaning is utilized at 2 schools. Here at the high school, we do a large portion of the cleaning at night, and we have one person over at the Coolidge Middle School. And we also outsource cleaning for the town buildings, Town Hall, Reading Public Library, Pleasant Street Center, and the police station. So this just gives you a quick breakdown of what each part of our organization does. School facilities made up of school custodians, courier, a facilities manager, a rentals coordinator, the cleaning contract, cleaning supplies, and cleaning equipment is in that piece. The core facilities budget is all the utilities, capital projects, repairs. It's made up of myself, an assistant director, a department secretary, and the three maintenance people that I spoke of. And then there is also another piece that we're really not going to get into deeply, but it's the town facilities budget, which is made up of town custodians, which is 4 people, the cleaning contract, cleaning supplies, and cleaning equipment. That's the three different breakouts right there. And again, that's just the organizational chart showing how we're set up. This is an important slide to use. There's a couple of things that have changed this year. This is all the technology that we use to run facilities. If you go to the, I think it's the next slide, John, this is just an example of what our work order system looks like. This is called Maintenance Direct. We are at every building in the town of Reading, school and town, we have users that are allowed to enter work orders. They come into my office, and then from there, these work orders are assigned to either a person and on our staff or an outside contractor, and we use that to track expenditures as well as where the daily workflow is going and to do planning. Facilities Direct is utilized to schedule all school rentals and invoicing. That's what the rentals coordinator handles for the town. And then FS Automation, this is a new piece that we rolled out last year. FS Automation ties the energy management system in with the rental. For an example, tonight we knew this was going on in here. It's not a rental, but it is an activity in this space here. And we reserve the space through FS Automation. It ties the energy management in to occupy this space for the period of time. So we've basically taken out a step by doing that. And it's good because if there's a cancellation for snow or we need to adjust a schedule, it's all intertwined with. So basically, it optimizes the run times on the buildings. Critical alarm automation is something we've had in play now for, I want to say it's been 4 years. This is a 24-hour monitoring system that sends out email, text, and work orders if we have a breakdown of a piece of equipment. At every building, we have a number of different points, and when I say a point, it could be a low temperature and a boiler, it could be a high temperature and a chiller, it could be no flow on a pump. But it'll tell us if there's a problem to avoid school cancellation or walking into a school that's 50 degrees in the morning. It also produces a work order, and we can route that directly to our vendors or a trades guy that works for the town of Reading. So this is a key piece right here. This is another piece we use here. This is Utility Track. We just rolled this out in the fall. This helps us. We were doing this with Excel, but now we have all of our buildings. We have 3 years in the system right now. We can track our consumption across all three utilities, water and sewer, natural gas and electricity. For all the utilities budget, as anybody knows, is a huge piece of my budget. It's over $1.5 million. And it's a moving target. And so this is an important piece of our budget to really watch very closely. About 3 weeks ago, we had a spike in one of our buildings on water, and come to find out it was a leak that we had in a crawl space. And so it was good that we caught this early. We've had this happen before at Coolidge, and it was like a 20 or 30% increase. We had a leak in the steam tunnel over there. We caught this one early because of this Utility Track program. So this is a great thing. It's good information. It took a long time to get it launched, but I'll show you a couple more slides later on. This one right here, it's just the energy management system. That's actually, I believe that's the high school right there. That just shows a snapshot of the boilers. That's what we see down in our office, or we can see remotely. We have the ability to remote in from anywhere that we have an internet connection to watch and change set points and diagnose problems on the energy management system for all the buildings in town. So some of the key functions of the facilities department is to maintain the work order system and manage the workflow. We perform routine maintenance and repairs on all the nine school and eight schools and nine municipal buildings. We manage and support the preventive maintenance program. Some of that is state mandated, some is not, but it's a pretty robust program that we launched about 8.5, 9 years ago. We provide project management for different functions, whether it be capital or small projects. We're collaborating with the Permanent Building Committee, which was just formed last year, and working very closely with them. We're doing long-term planning for capital and for space. We coordinate outside contractors on a daily basis down in facilities, following state-mandated inspection schedules, and a lot of what we do is dictated by that. Capital planning and project management and implementation. You know, when we do work in any of the school buildings, especially the schools, you know, we try to get it all wrapped up within the fiscal year, but it's challenging with the bidding laws and trying to work projects in over the summer and for as little amount of disruption to the school buildings as possible. So it's pretty challenging, so we try to stay on top of that stuff. We manage the custodial service for all the town and school buildings. I had mentioned the contracts earlier. And we manage and track energy and fuel consumption through utility track. This slide right here is just going to show you over a 12-month period, over the 2,400 work orders that we completed. It kind of shows you month to month where the work goes, but it'll show you like in June of 16, the spike, and that has a lot to do with work orders getting entered into the system when school gets out. And then again in September when the kids come back, we always get a big influx of work orders coming in because there's requests and changes and room assignments and things like that. That's just the organizational chart. This is some stats on the buildings. You can see most of the buildings have been renovated except for the Killam Elementary School on the school side, but our buildings are in really good shape. On the town side, most of the buildings over there have been renovated, the oldest one being the cemetery garage, which we just took on last year, which is across from the town hall. I talk about capital. Here's some FY17 capital projects we completed. We did this first one with the town technology and the school technology department, replacing the UPS batteries in the data centers here at the high school and at the town hall. Police station, I'm sorry. Main Street Fire Station, we did some flooring replacements over there. Police station, same. Killam, we did some work over there, and you can see the picture to the right is the high D area that we completed, and we put some of the high visibility strips on the edging going down into the kivas. Some HVAC upgrades over at Killam. We redid the epoxy floor over at the Wood End School. Some carpeting again at Parker High School here. We put a new main DPW garage main entrance door at the DPW facility, and we did a lot of sidewalk repair up here at the high school. Some remaining capital that we have still to finish is some HVAC upgrades at the Wood End Elementary School. We're doing an upgrade to the Honeywell energy management system. We're doing a software upgrade. It's going to touch all the buildings, and we're going to be putting a new roof on the West Side Fire Station. Some special projects we completed. In addition to the capital, we did the LCCA, which is the Lead Contamination Control Act, which touched a lot of our schools. We replaced some soffit vents over at the Barrows. We conducted, every 2 years we do roof inspections with a consultant to help keep good track of our condition of our roofs for our capital plan. We did interior painting at every school this summer. We implemented the utility track program I was speaking about earlier. Installed some ceiling fans up here in the high school. We did, I think it was 12, was it 6 or 12 rooms? 12 rooms. We did an LED light conversion at the Joshua Eaton. If you've been over there recently, we replaced 135 fixtures over there. Every hallway light has been now replaced with the high efficiency LED package light. We did that and we received a rebate from Reading Municipal Light. We took advantage of that and we're gonna be doing the same thing again this year. To some other buildings. Some exterior painting at Town Hall, which finished a project I started a year and a half ago. We started, and we did some work in the inspectional services area at Town Hall, and we also did some work for the DPW at the break room in the kitchen, which is the picture to the right, and interior and exterior painting at the Pleasant Street Center. This one right here just shows you some of those projects on the previous slides. You know, where the number of in-house labor hours that we used to get those projects done, just to give you an idea what it took. This one right here is work orders by selected craft, and you can see where the work is going, boiler, carpentry, clocks and bells. So we can kind of narrow it down to the specific trade where we're doing the work, which is a great tool. This one right here is the 2,400 work orders, but it shows you where most of the work happened. A question was asked of me, and it didn't occur to me till after, but why 236 work orders at Wood End? And that's because the principal and the staff at the Wood End School used School Dude religiously and put everything on a work order up there. So they fully take advantage of that system. A lot of people will email, and sometimes, so it's good. And we get a lot of the full benefit of the work order program in a school like Wood End. It doesn't mean that there's a high number of breakdowns or anything like that. And the other thing to keep in mind is in these numbers is our PMs. Preventive maintenance work orders get also generated. And those, like at the high school, if you look around, you can see all the mechanical equipment on the roof of the high school when you drive by. That is also considered a work order, okay, a preventive maintenance work order. So this is just a purpose summary right here. This just shows you, again, it's drilling down a little further into critical alarms, facility scheduling, general maintenance, office moves, other preventive maintenance. Down at the bottom, there's the number of no assigned purpose. That number has dropped down because we actually, to stay in close contact with the work order, the company that we, School Dude, who we get the work order system from. So there are some crafts and some purposes, if you will, that they don't have ability to assign anything to yet, so we can expand on that, so that'll be even further broken out in years to come, just so you guys know. And over, I'm sorry, John, just one second. And over on the right, it just gives you the number of work orders. Again, it's just a different way of showing that other slide. Sorry. So this next slide right here is for the utility track. Shows you a 30-month consumption on natural gas at the high school. And if you look where we're tracking year to date, we're doing pretty good. It's been kind of mild, but we're in pretty good shape here at the high school. This next slide is a combination of all three utilities. And you can see we're tracking pretty good right now. If you look at the bottom, don't pay any attention to the bottom. That's when we were first entering the information into the system and playing around with getting it up online. So it's showing a flat line for 13. But we're tracking really well right now in the utility budget. Basically shows you we're in line. So the school facilities budget. We're looking at doing as you all know, we're looking to decrease $80,000 in contract cleaning services here at the Reading High School. This impact and the reduction will mean shifting some of the high school cleaning to the three full-time custodians at the high school. We're working with the cleaning contractor they're just finishing up their first year here. We've got a really good company in place right now. It's unfortunate that we're going to be cutting this, but we feel like we can, between them changing their cleaning frequencies in the building, maybe not doing glass every night, maybe not buffing every night, and by us shifting some of the responsibility on the custodians that are under our supervision, you know, we can make this happen. It's the building might not have a high shine every day, but we will have a clean building, and we will, you know, keep the costs down by doing this. So that's how we're planning on managing that. The next thing is a decrease in the 60. Is that?
That's a decrease in the offset from the used school property based upon reviewing the balances.
Okay. And then, you know, obviously there's a cost of living adjustment for the collective bargaining.
On the majority of the items, as we talked about, the increases in there are based upon the contractual increases. I do want to point out that if you look at the other salaries line, that 9.7% increase is a result of a decrease in the offset, which flows into that line item. So because the offset is going down, it is bumping up that line item. So that accounts for the 9.7% increase. It is not a 9.7 increase in wages or salaries.
So you have a combination of the two. You have the contractual increases plus the decreases. Yeah.
So I think if on page 71 of the budget book, there's the further breakout of the facilities budget by detail, and you can see if you go across the other salaries, the largest change within there is the decrease in the offset. because I know that question, we had also that question had come up as well. So we wanted to address that one. And the rest of them were all going through and looking at the individual line items and also reflect in the contract services the decrease
yep.
that Joe just spoke to. The staffing headcount, there have been no changes in the FTEs. The only changes are the contractual increases reflected within their salaries. The headcount has remained consistent year over year. And then I think I jumped ahead and went to pace.
Can you jump back to that slide that had the impact?
Yes.
That one?
Yes.
So, okay, so it's not the decreases through the cleaning company, not through the
correct, FTEs. Not through FTEs. Well,
yeah, we're not reducing FTEs, we're reducing the contract of the cleaning company.
And so as I understood the way you explained it is, so we're going to move that work from the back to our own employees?
There'll be certain areas in the high school that the cleaning contractor does right now that we're talking with them about our folks taking over here at the high school, and you know it's gonna be kind of a give and take. We might say to them, for instance, maybe we'll do the library, the media center during the day or the morning, and maybe they won't do as much floor buffing or glass cleaning or dusting on a nightly basis. So
can I? We signed a contract, though. I mean, how do we just go back in the middle of the contract and say we want
It's subject to appropriation, and we can reduce the value of the contract. And we did check with our procurement person on the town side. So we did this through Combis, that's how we procured this particular service, a 30B. But you're able to reduce under Combis, which we did. We negotiated with them.
So I don't know how far down the road we are with this, but I mean, did we go to the contractor and say, we'd like you to keep doing the work you can do, either you can take $80,000 less and do less, or you can figure out a way to do it for cheaper. I mean, we've been down this road where we've cut back, I mean, we're going back a few years where we took a lot of criticism for cutting back building maintenance, and I just, this is like one of those things we were talking, you just start going down this road, it's like cutting capital. You start doing it, it's a gimmick. It's another way to, cut the budget that isn't going to get a lot of fanfare, but it's going to hurt us long term, I think.
Joe and I have had a lot of conversations about this, and I think Joe said it best. You're not going to see So, but what you are going to see is a clean building, because there are going to be areas that will be taken over by our in-house custodians, and things that would get done necessarily that are getting done right now every night are getting done every other night. So we're not going downhill with maintenance.
This is not the core budget. This is not rooftop equipment maintenance. This is cleaning. The other thing is too is we didn't get well. It is, but one thing we did not give up is the vacation cleanings. In the contract, there's vacation cleanings that Christmas vacation, February, April vacation. There's four big cleanings, right, Kevin? Summer cleaning, a big one. Those are still in the contract, and those are when they're going to get the building snapped back into shape again. That's when you'll get the floor finish put back down. We didn't give up that. We could have very easily taken all those cleanings out and kept the nightly Jan up, but that would have killed us. It was better to do this and do alternate night cleaning. I used to work for a contract cleaning company years and years ago, and this is not uncommon for a way to get there. It would be, obviously we want the building to stand tall. It's the newest building in the whole town. it will, you won't see, you will see a little bit different quality in the way it looks, but it's not going to be a dirty building. I can assure you of that.
I'm not worried about you. I'm just, I believe you. I'm just.
Yep, I understand.
Just because it's on this subject, so I agree with Chuck, because from one perspective, I mean, I was here when we just needed to do the new high school building. But I have sort of two perspectives on it. I did actually listen to and watch Mr. Huggins' presentation to the Board of Selectmen the other night, and as I was watching it, I was thinking, I feel both ways about this. Why are we still doing all this preventative maintenance? And we're, you know, cutting so deeply on our school budget. So I was sort of watching it going like, you know, it's not making sense to me. Like, I understand we need to do preventative maintenance. And so it sounded to me from what I saw that night and what I've read here, we're not reducing any of our preventative maintenance. And I was sort of questioning, is that a place where we could be giving a little bit more so that we don't have to give so much in the places that we heard about tonight? So I, you know, again, I'm just saying that I feel both ways about it, but it seems like that, you know, you've got the custodians are going to pick up at least the things that you think are really important. I had a question about, we've got all these tools to, you know, manage and track and help us, you know, do a better job pinpointing where we need to take action. But is the custodial, is there like sort of tracking on sort of that general cleaning, the day-to-day cleaning too, or not? I mean, how is that, are you using a system to, like, you know, make sure that if the library is supposed to get cleaned every 3 days, that that's actually happening?
So all the buildings have, Kevin has a work list for all the custodians, so that we basically, if someone's covering in the building, there's something they have, they can get the, you know, what do I do at Wood End? I'll use Wood End as an example again. Or what does the nighttime custodian at the high school do? So we do know where our custodians are and what gets cleaned during the day and what gets cleaned during the night. It's a lot different than, so yeah, there's a task list to answer your question.
But not like, it's not on a work order system.
We do use a work order system to direct the custodians, because there are setups and things like that that happen during the day. Like at the elementary schools, they might have something that requires a full breakdown and setup of, like at Birchie, for an example. We had to break down the whole cafeteria and set it back up again within like 2 hours, and it was maintenance guys and custodial over there. Mm-hmm. It's just part of what we do. So we do use it for the custodial staff.
So I think it's a road that we don't want to get down, but I think given where we are, where, you know, we're not going to be as shiny, and these buildings don't have the terrazzo floors or the tile floors that mm-hmm. other districts installed, and it's never going to look quite like that. Mm-hmm. And we're going to have to just, you know, keep a good eye on it and watch it.
Yeah, and to answer your question before about the preventive maintenance and the you know, the core budget, the funding for our repairs and maintenance, a lot of that, like I said, is state mandated. I can't, there's no way of getting around how many times you have an elevator serviced or we have a fire alarm system tested. Mm-hmm. That stuff we have to continue to fund that. The other thing is that when we did the performance contracting initiative in 09 and 10, we're required to, in order to keep the guarantee going, which is for 15 years, if we can't prove that we're maintaining our equipment and we don't hit our consumption, if you remember.
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
So, and not to mention that, it's just good practice. You got to maintain your equipment. Years ago, it dropped way down, and we've done a good job of bringing it back up, so.
I know it's good practice, but we're just, I just, you know, there's all kinds of good practices that got talked about tonight that we cannot execute on because we don't have the funding. So I have other questions, but I figured we'd let him finish the presentation.
He was done, right?
Are you done?
Mr. Nyan had one. Do you mind if I go to him and then Dr. Dawson can come back to you just to Mr. Nyan?
So as Chuck said, and as you know, $80,000 is a lot of money. It must be a lot of work that is now being shifted onto the custodians. Is it, you know, from what I'm understanding is we won't be able to perform at the same level. They'll have to pick up, you know, additional work, but I guess the thing I'm looking at is, didn't they have a full load to begin with, and now we're asking them to do that much more?
custodial staff?
Yeah, I'm talking about the high school custodial staff, who's everyone at night.
If we shift anything, whatever we do, decide to shift onto them, and I'll talk with John about this, we'll make sure that it's fair and equitable for the guys that they can do it. We're not going to ask them to do more than they can do in their eight-hour shift. They're definitely going to be busier, without a doubt. But I think even the stuff that they're going to take over will be stuff, again, that'll be on a reduced frequency. That's how we're going to get to that end goal, to save the money. I'm not going to say to the custodian, you know, here, take the auditorium over and clean it every single night. It'll be go in there and check it and make sure that, you know, the trash is emptied and that there's no stains in the carpet and the trash is picked up and get out of there. It'll be that type of thing. We haven't gotten down to that level of it. We have a general idea of what areas we're talking about. But once we reallocate the work, the labor, we'll figure that out.
I was wondering if you could tell us a little bit about the courier position. It's on page 3. Well, I know.
Yeah, we have a courier position here that we've had now for, I want to say we've had him at least 12 years has been a courier. It was a full-time position. Going back in, I think it was 2000, you might remember, John, maybe 2008.
We reduced it down.
Yep. So we reduced it down to where it is right now. I will tell you that the person is very busy that does the job. He does runs around for all the inter-school, Reading Public Library. He does runs to the town hall. This is all part of conducting business, the business that we do as a school district as well as a town. He also assists in doing science kit delivery, which is a big thing, curriculum thing that he is assisting doing. So he's running from the time he does, I will tell you, he's running from the time he gets in until he goes. There's no extra time there.
He doesn't do it, then that's going to have to get picked up by administrators, secretaries, custodians.
Right.
That's going to have, yeah, because you still have mail going back and forth between town and school buildings and school buildings. Every day.
Thank you.
Thanks. Yep. I had a question about does the FS automation allow like variable input so that you could put input like for this room, how occupied you expect it to be, so that it does the energy management for you?
So if we rent it, let's say that we're going to rent the, I'll use the pack as it's an easier example, but if we're going to rent the pack out for a play, yeah. Steve will put the rental in there and rent it from 6 p.m. till 11 o'clock at night. And it automatically ties the energy management system into that. So we'll have both air handlers running.
Oh, and it monitors as the BTU output of the room changes, it
will throttle back.
That's something that the EMS does on its own, okay. Separate. This just ties the two together.
And on the EMS system, do our people build the systems like you showed the system for the high school heating? How does that get in there? Do our people like put that data in there to create the system, or do you have to?
No, we bought that system you were looking at is a Johnson Controls package, and basically it was all the software that we bought, and then they put all of our equipment into it.
Oh,
they load it up. Yep.
I have one other. Could you go back to the mission slide for a minute, if possible? So. I just have a comment here because this is new, right? This, our core facilities and having you as leader, and I'm just continually impressed with the way that you leverage technology as a efficient mechanism to accomplish the goal.
Thank you.
And I think it's like state of the art. It's better than the company that I work for. But I just want to say one of the things I think is really important here as you read this is that this says the facilities department is going to support the town's educational and municipal government functions. And really, this was an important part as we established this. The town is made up of the educational and the municipal functions, the school and the municipal buildings. And we must look at everything we do through that lens. And so I want to thank you for explicitly stating that in this mission, and I think it's something that's really important. When we say the town of Reading, it means all of that. There is no town side or school side. the town is the educational and municipal functions and the facilities that support those functions. So I really just want to say this is a new mission for you. I want to give some feedback that I think that you hit the mark and appreciate that.
Thank you.
You know, you serve truly the entire town, and I appreciate that.
Thank you.
Actually, Mrs. Webb, that you bring up a really good point. The reorganization that was done to create the town court is only a couple of years old.
Two?
This is our second year, right, John?
Yeah. Going in.
And we're having this conversation, and it's effortless. I mean, it really is a testament to how you've handled it. So I think that's a really good point. Thank you.
I'm sorry. I don't mean to. Did you ever pick on the courier? I can't find it in the. I've never seen that before.
Oh, it might not be on this.
No,
it's probably in the, yeah, yeah.
What does that represent, 0.5, do you know?
Well, what do you mean?
What's the salary?
Oh, the salary.
Oh, it's like, it's under $18 an hour, I want to say.
It's small. I can look it up. I don't remember.
Is the courier fully funded then out of the school operating budget?
Yes.
Yes.
And is the other half of the person doing something else, or is he just a half?
He's a half.
It's the 0.5 of the 18.5.
No, I get that. I was just curious what was it costing.
We can add it to our questions for Monday.
I remember they...
Is that part of the collective bargaining unit, or just for...
Yeah.
Is that part of the collective bargaining unit, or is it just part of that line item for budgeting purposes?
That position is in the collective bargaining. It's a custodian. It's considered a custodian.
Yes, gotcha. Thank you.
I wanted to highlight one of the improvements and reductions in that was my past tenure on the school committee. Do you remember? They used to deliver the packets. Where's Linda? She's here. Right. Not only make the courier, you used to have to deliver paper packets to us before
like
we advance the meetings.
Was he riding a pony?
He was riding a pony. At least we're not still. No, we're not.
There are some things that we need to still deliver that are paper based. They can't be electronic based.
Or it sounds like it's like the science kits.
Yeah, that's just one of the things he might deliver supplies if we have an emergency and we need something delivered to one of the buildings. We'll ask him to do that. Mm-hmm. But
Mr. Blompin, you had a question.
Yeah, two questions. One is just about utilities. So can we go to the slide that had the utilities graph, the mountain when we had all the snow?
Yeah, and there's
so
another, okay.
A mountain of snow and a mountain of money to go with it, I think. And this you can follow up on later. I'm just curious what it costs in the winter versus the summer. You have 8 buildings for the school to do everything you need to do to make that climate habitable. So the price of all in lights, heating, cooling, electric, forget about the services, just the physical building. So I'm assuming the building is a certain way on the weekends if no one was using it, or at night, let's say. And then when you put people in the building, you gotta heat it up or cool it down or mm-hmm. all kinds of other things. Do you have a sense of what that delta is per day across all the buildings? So if I give you some idea of what I'm thinking of. If you look at a number, let's say 5,000, so that's 225 per day for a 22 school day month, right? If you just divide that by 22, right? So if this building for the high school, you'll get $200 to $900 a day, and that's natural gas costs. And so I'm just curious, if school was open versus school being closed on a winter day versus a hot day in the summer, is that $4,000 or $5,000 a day difference across the whole district, or is that?
I'd have to run the numbers.
We can certainly get that.
I don't expect you to know off the top of your head, but I'm just curious
what that
is. We
can get that for you as part of the question.
That's fine.
You know, it's even if the school is closed, even if this building was shut down right now and it was 10 degrees outside, I still have to give you 50. I still have to keep it at 50 degrees to avoid a freeze up.
Understood.
Definitely cheaper to run it at 50 degrees than it is to run it at 72 degrees or 70.
Right.
So, electricity in the summer is a whole different animal. We don't have cooling in all of our schools, but the electricity where you do have cooling is a big cost. It's a big cost to cool space.
Okay.
Versus the gas for the heat.
What was that?
Versus gas for the heat.
Correct.
Just curious about the difference between a running school on a hot day versus running school on a cold day, or not running school at all on either one of those. And then I have a separate question, but I can come back to it if you want.
Okay,
totally
so Mr. Knight?
So, Gail, can you explain? I'm just confused on the $60,000 in the offset from the use of school properties revolving account. How do we, can you just explain how that I'm not questioning it, I just don't get it.
We reviewed the balances within the revolving accounts, and given where the current balance is and what we're projecting it to be, it cannot sustain the level of offset that we are currently taking. So we needed to reduce it. One of the charts we have going forward is we're actually monitoring it this year, because it is right now looking as if it could go negative at the end of this year. So we needed to adjust the offsets in order to make it sustainable based upon the revenue.
So does that minus mean we're taking more out?
We're taking less out. We reduced, you know, the offsets are always, we reduced the offsets. We used to take a higher amount into the general fund from the use of school properties, but the balance cannot sustain it, so we had to reduce the amount. So it causes an increase.
Okay, I get it now.
It looks a little odd, because if I'm looking at page 71, right, that's the...
It's the 240 to the 180.
Right, but the prior year were, last year the adopted budget at 240 was very high, so that negative 25 is relative to FY17, but if you were looking at that relative to the average of the prior 3 years, it wouldn't be that big of a drop. So.
Correct. I know part of it too, there was... Based upon the audit that we had received, there was a lot of work done, because the revolving account balances had grown to a level that were higher than they should be based upon how you're supposed to maintain them. So we have increased the offsets to help bring the balances down, but that level is not sustainable going forward.
Since you brought that up, I always get her name. It's Karen? Is she the town accountant?
Sharon.
Sharon. That's close. Have you met with her regarding that audit that was done?
I actually have. I meet with Sharon on a pretty frequent basis. It used to almost be weekly or twice a week when I first came on, and she has shared the audit report with me, and we do have time scheduled in February to revisit it. Being new, I want to make sure I am addressing all of them, and we will be revisiting all of the revolving accounts to make sure all of our documentation and everything is addressing the items that were brought up as part of the audit, which I believe was
The adjustments that are in this budget reflect a lot of the conversations that Sharon and Gail have been having.
Right, and I'm looking at the revolving account as of June 30th, 2016, in the kindergarten kid. I've been all over the place on it, but it's towards the back. I'm just wondering, it seems like it seems very healthy to me. And I'm just wondering, with those 3.3 paraprofessionals.
So we are going to talk about revolving accounts later, so I don't know.
Yeah, okay.
We want to.
All right.
You're right.
We're doing that tonight, or are we doing that another time?
We'll see.
I'm up for another time.
It could be Monday. It could be Monday if it's not tonight.
I'm up for Monday.
I think Joe should go through.
We're getting a field of facilities. Two more slides. It's an important conversation.
I think Joe may have actually. Did you have two more?
Slides.
Sorry. Yeah. Oh, sorry, Joe.
I don't want to talk about it if you don't want.
This is not in your budget book.
Yeah, this is the core budget right here. So this just shows you FY17, FY18. And again, that's just basically a COLA and then obviously collective bargaining for the first piece. Maintenance expenses are up just a little bit, that line right there. And that's basically equipment that the facilities guys use to purchase tools and things like that, expendable items for their trucks and so on and so forth. School repair expense is flat. School utilities is up 5% on that, and that's all three utilities, obviously. Town repair expense is up $60,000, and that's a one-time uptick that you're gonna see right there for some work we're gonna be doing at the police station booking area, the senior center, and the town hall. That's money that was drawn over from the town's operating budget by the town manager. That's a one-time thing right there.
Okay.
Town utilities again is up 5%, and then the total is to just under $3 million.
Where did the
5% come from?
The 5% came from RMLD, largely, increased with electricity.
Well, not the gas, really?
The gas, we're locked into a pretty good contract right now till 2018. We're paying like $6.38 per decatherm, I think it is right now. We got a good price.
What's the percent increase? I'm not confident in my math.
It's it's like 5%.
On the utilities?
On everything.
Yeah, it's 5%, 4.9.
This is the town budget.
This is the core. This is the core budget.
This is the core budget.
I gotcha. Okay.
The only budget that you would vote on is this one.
All right.
We just thought you wanted to see where.
We just wanted to see the core budget.
I didn't want to.
Where the responsibility is shared.
Yep.
So this is the core piece of the plan that's accommodated.
Yes.
Yep. Utilities are common.
A lot.
Part of it is
something that we're interested in.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Absolutely.
So Joe, that's just the town side or all together?
So the core budget represents, like I said, that's the main budget. We have, there's three separate budgets I manage. The core is the big piece, which is myself, the department secretary, the assistant director, and the facilities maintenance guys. That's the salaries. Maintenance expenses is everything we do that's the equipment for the trucks. I'm sorry. The next one down, school repair expenses is all we do to repair and maintain the school buildings. Then the school utilities is just what it says it is. And then town repair expenses is, again, the repair and maintenance for all the upkeep on the town buildings. And then the town utilities.
Mr. Bobbin.
Could we go back two slides? You just flashed the school one more. Yes. So I think this is for Dr. Daugherty. Some history here. Other salaries is jumping around a lot. And I don't know if those were easy because like down 30, up 70, down 40, and now it's up 71, 17 to 18.
On page 71, that's the revolving account.
That's what it's happening.
Yeah,
it's, that
the
has
shifts
been,
in revolving account. That's
okay.
The detail on that one is on page 71. There's a separate line for that, so you can see that has moved around. And I wanted to answer the question on the cost for the courier. It's $22,000.
And I know I said this a meeting or two ago, but it bears repeating because of that question. Sort of a note for the future is putting revolving fund offsets in this way can make it harder to see expenses. So just how can you do that differently going forward is a future challenge. Yeah, Mr. Knight.
One more question. So Joe, how tight, at the end of the year, how tight is your budget when you get back to like, June 30th?
It depends. It depends on what kind of winter we've had. It depends on what kind of, we have a line in our budget called extraordinary repair expense, and that's to cover us for breakdowns. If it was a catastrophic failure that was going to be, I would then go to the finance committee and ask for money. But if it's something that we can handle within our budget, that's where the extraordinary repair lines get
tapped. So
that could be a compressor failure at a building. It could be a pump that could cost like $3,000 or $4,000. I mean, you can get multiple breakdowns like that. As well as we maintain the buildings, you just don't know. So if those are low and we have a mild winter, then we could have a savings in our budget. The money goes back into the buildings for improvements at the end of the year. We might do some painting, or we might do an energy management. We might do a major PM. Mm-hmm. And when I say that, we might just go through and have them rip apart every piece of equipment on the rooftops and pour the extra money back into the equipment just to keep it running good.
No more snow blowers up on the roof of Kelman?
No. You can see me do that.
Can you hear that?
No.
Any other questions from the committee? Dr. Dox.
I have two. One has come from communications with others. People that mentioned small changes that can be additive in terms of helping. One of the charts mentioned postage as a cost. some of the things that go into that? Is there?
We did have that question that
I did submit.
You did submit.
Yeah, so that'll be answered on Monday night.
So that'll be answered. I don't.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Oh, so some of the questions are Monday, so.
Yeah, I'm sorry. And the other question actually is just trying to understand. I just a flag went up to me when I heard the question about cold and hot days and the difference. And I want to be really careful about the time we're asking you guys to spend on research. And I wanted to understand what the benefit of that question was. And I guess I wanted to just say that when I think about hot days and I think about having been in the high school and our un-air-conditioned schools on hot days, that it's not a place I would want our kids to be more than they have, or our teachers to be more than they have to be. So saving money in terms of keeping people in our schools on hot days rather than heating during a cold day, to me, is not a viable solution. So I needed to understand that question. Because I think we need to think about who we're talking about and the conditions we're having them learn in. Mm-hmm. No one learns when they're sweating and sticking to their seats and
well,
dehydrated.
Wood End's doing pretty well.
Yeah. So I just wanted to understand that question.
Yeah, the question for me?
Yeah, I guess.
Okay. So, no, I don't know all those conditions either. The point of the question was not whether we should put students in schools that are hot or cold, anything other than what they should be for a student to learn. The question is directed to if we are looking at the school calendar and deciding to have a day in August versus a day in December out of our 100 and however many days we have, when does it make a difference
where
in terms of the cost?
Vacations.
Where do we put vacation days?
Yeah.
Do we add a day to winter break? Do we add a day to summer break? Do we add a day to spring break? Is there a delta there? I'm absolutely not suggesting that we conduct science experiments on students in terms of the effect of temperature on learning.
We may have to, though, because we don't get that, Adam.
So that was my point, was just if we're going to close school, is there a dollars bottom line difference of any kind? And there may not be. And to be clear, I'm not looking for, if this is a lot of work, I'm happy to say that involves a lot of work. There's no appreciable difference. But if you happen to know, hey, it's tremendously more expensive to pay for mm-hmm. electricity than natural gas. We'd rather heat the place than cool the place. Mm-hmm. That's perhaps a consideration, but if it's, you know, total $500, maybe, hey, we eat a lot of pizza in this district. That's a few pizzas, I don't know. But if we get a sense of whether that has any effect on,
that's a good question.
My point is $500 students could use that, and if we could give students something, you know, like pizza party, and we could change the school calendar or something like that. It was just an idea. Is there a difference in cost to have the school open or closed in the winter or the summer? That's what I'm getting at.
Yeah, my only comment, and not to the effect, is that usually when school's not in session, it still is open for a variety of reasons. We have extended day programs, summer programs. If it's during the summer, there are special education extended year programs.
We do
athletics
all
is going on.
We're doing all our state mandated inspections on closed days,
so
too.
So the building isn't closed, so utilities are still.
Well, I'm just asking the question.
Yeah.
That's
when we would be able to, like, even, and it's difficult. We do it in the summertime, we do fire alarm testing up here.
Right.
You love that.
Oh, yeah.
But we have to get it done, and it, you know, it's a disruption, and that's the only thing. We have to do it in the summertime or in a break period.
Yeah, so if there's no difference, that's a perfectly helpful response. Thank you. So,
at least one question from the community. So are there any more from the committee? Ms. Williams, did you have a question?
Yes,
and thank you for your patience.
My question was more just sort of thinking outside the box and finding creative ways to save money. And one of the things that came to mind was with the custodian, you guys were saying the building's not going to be spick and span. Has anyone ever thought disciplinary action for some of the students, those days that the custodial staff's not working, they're the ones washing the windows? I mean, Am I crazy? I came from a parochial school, so.
Make the kids clean the building.
You can't
just do bad kids clean
just
the
building.
Having students clean the building.
Not all the time, but
no, but I don't think.
That requires, I can answer
better,
that, but.
Have moms and dads say, you know what? I'm signing my children up as much.
We do get kids come in for community service hours.
Yes, we do.
And that works out okay. But just having someone come in here to try to, you know, get hours in on a regular basis, you know, to clean a set of classrooms, from a management standpoint, it just doesn't work.
We don't have that many bad kids.
It's very difficult to, you know, we'd have to put someone in charge of that particular person.
Right, but just know that every other day, like, the windows, like, need to be washed, so Monday, Wednesday, Friday, that kind of, I don't know, just, I was just thinking outside the box.
Yeah.
Community service makes sense, but you can't punish students, essentially tell them
you
gotta go clean the bathroom.
You can do some restorative justice type activities in lieu of a suspension, that type of thing, yes.
But, yeah, is it systemic enough to be a solution to the problem? It doesn't sound like it would be. Did you have another one, Ms. Lynch?
I just had one other quick creative outside the box thinking, with the courier service. I mean, there's a lot, today I was from the high school to Birch, back to the high school, back to Birch. And, you know, I could be currying something from the main office. Has anyone ever explored buying a secure bag? Because these are obviously confidential documents going back and forth with a lot that, you know, parents from the PTO have put out, you know, a list that says, you know, does anyone want to sign up and just transfer stuff over to help save money? I mean, honestly, at the end of the day, all these little changes, they can make a big difference.
Well, my gut reaction is you really need an employee to be moving confidential information from school to school or from school to town.
Right.
It can't really be a volunteer activity.
He does all the warrants.
And you've got warrants, you've got payroll,
he's going back and forth.
A lot of things are going back and forth.
I think it was mentioned that the municipal discussion, the Board of Selectmen discussion, that event technicians are students, is that right? So were you using students? I don't know if they get paid or stipended to do that.
They get paid.
Okay.
Yeah. I think it's like $10 an hour or something.
But it's students who are.
It's getting the
raise. And they're fabulous. Thank you. Yeah.
Very delighted whether we could put solar panels on the facilities. And she said there was something in the RMLD contract that prevented that. Now we're a couple years on, I'll just ask the question again. And I know RMLD has asked ratepayers to help them set up a new solar facility. And I wonder whether any of the rooftops would be suitable and whether they're more open to that idea now.
You have to have a certain amount of square feet or acreage on a roof to do it. Don't have none of our roofs, from what we were told, don't lend themselves to having a solar array on them because of the amount of equipment we have on our rooftops. We had talked about like over on the side of the building here near the Performing Arts Center, but again, it's not facing in the right direction to capture the sun. But we do use, just so you know, I don't know if you're aware of this, but we are using solar preheat on this building, which a lot of people don't know. Which is on the parapet on the side wall of the auditorium. It's a preheat. Actually, it heats the space. It's a giant box. It's about 80 feet long. It's 10 feet high that collects air, and then it gets heated up by the sun so that the unit that heats the space doesn't have to go into high fire. So on a 30-degree day, the air coming in is 70 degrees already. And we are doing solar domestic at a couple of buildings on the town side, just so you know. But a solar array or a large one, just it doesn't lend itself to doing it on any of our rooftops, just so you're aware.
That was good to know.
Yeah.
Anything else?
No, but we should be done because it's way too late.
Thank you again.
All right, thank you very much. Have a good night.
It's 10 o'clock.
How would everybody feel about putting revolving funds off to starting Monday night's meeting?
Yeah, good idea.
I would like that. Is the committee agreeable to that?
Yes.
Okay. And you are hopeful to get questions, all of the questions. And I want to thank the members of the committee. Each of you submitted many, many budget questions. So good luck to Ms. Dowd and Dr. Doherty answering them all. And I know you're going to answer the questions from the public hearing tonight and other discussions.
Yeah, a lot of them are duplicates.
I wanted to keep the public hearing going, but I thought to say, as people were talking, like, yep, someone asked that, yep, someone asked that. So, but that's good. It's the more voices, the better. All right. Do I have a motion?
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Good evening.